Hello, everyone, and welcome to Christian Hangout number 19, where we are once again topic-free, but we hope to have a good conversation all the same. We have got several newcomers here with us this time. We have three so far, actually. And so, as we normally do around here, we'd like to ask them to introduce themselves and tell us a little bit about their backgrounds as Christians. So I guess we'll just go from left to right as we see it down here. Let's start with Mr. Fox. Would you like to introduce yourself?
My Twitter handle is Duro Coondog. Yeah, I was raised...
Coon with a K.
Yeah, Duro with a K. Yeah, Duro with a K. Coon with a K. Yeah. I was raised in a big Christian family and was raised in a church, did mission trips and all that stuff. I'm Southern Baptist too, so.
Okay.
I like to give stuff short and sweet, so.
Okay, so you're a Southern Baptist who was raised in the church. Okay.
Yeah, for a very long time. Still practicing, so. Still practicing.
Cool.
Still practicing.
All right. So, anything else, or?
Nothing. Oh yeah, I'm also the executive producer of Illusion Radio.
Illusion Radio. Okay. Cool stuff. All right. So let's, I guess next we have Rachel. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. I am Rachel Dahl. That's my real name. And I tweet at the handle Alamodest. So that's Alamodest. And that's also the same name as my blog, alamodest.com. And I was raised Christian. My family is the first to become, I would say evangelicals, and the rest of my family from my extended family are Catholics. And because I was raised in the Philippines, that Catholics are kind of what permeates the Philippines. It's just from, from our history, our history with Spanish people, and that's why my extended family is mostly Catholics. But I was just raised from a family that became evangelicals, I guess, by the time I was born. And I guess I would say, like I told Ian earlier, I didn't actually start reading the Bible for myself until around middle school. And from then on, I was really serious about my faith. Just basically when I started understanding the Bible. That's about it. And I guess right now I go to an evangelical free church that's not a 501c3 church, which I'm pretty proud of.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Cool. Anything else, or?
No, that's it.
Okay. And now we also have Scott Mallett with us. Would you like to tell us a little bit about your background, Scott?
Sure. My name is Scott Mallett, and I'm on Twitter as Scott Mallett. My family's religious background is a combination of Church of Latter-day Saints and Southern Baptist. So naturally, I became Eastern Orthodox about 20 years ago. I currently attend a very, very traditional Anglo-Catholic parish, and consider myself a traditionalist and a perennialist. That's it.
Okay, cool. Perennialist. We've talked a little bit about perennialism. Like, could you care to define that for anybody listening who doesn't know what that means?
Oh boy.
I know it's a big thing, but just kind of a basic idea.
In 500 words or less.
The idea underlying perennialism is that there's a primary essential truth that's revealed through a variety of legitimate spiritual traditions. as a Christian Western perennialist, I see Christianity as the preeminent expression of the perennial tradition, but that's not true of all perennialists. But we also see value and truth in the other revealed religions, the traditional religions like Hinduism and Islam and Buddhism and so forth.
Okay. Yeah, I've heard that said before. Just not to get off on a tangent here, get off on a change the subject completely, but is there somebody who's heard like a bell ringing earlier? Was somebody outside or something?
Yes, I heard that. It wasn't me, but I heard it.
Was that you,
I'm walking around my neighborhood, and there's a Catholic church, a lovely Catholic church across from my house near the park, and that was the bells.
I thought, yeah.
I'm next to my toaster oven. You might have heard that too. I don't know.
Not sure. Somebody in the text chat was complaining about heavy breathing, so I don't know.
Actually, the church bells came on.
Kill you.
Okay.
See, my college town has like church bells that ring too, so it's pretty nice.
I'll mute next time they come on.
It's fine. If it's church bells, it might brighten our day a little bit.
Yeah.
I thought it sort of worked, but I'll mute.
It does work. We can't really censor the church bells on the Christian hangout. That wouldn't really.
It'd be
communist.
So.
Hey, and if it was a Muslim hangout, they could kill us for it.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. What would a Jew hangout do? So.
Thinking of course.
Oy, shut it down.
Shut it down.
Oy, they're going with the bells. I can't sleep. David, go tell the Christian neighbors to shut up with that racket.
And we're already hemorrhaging viewers here. So, okay, so yeah. So,
wait, is this on YouTube?
This is on YouTube?
Okay.
Yeah, I linked to it on Twitter if you see the link. I pinned it to my main Twitter page.
Now, I'm surprised you didn't get in trouble. Remember, what was it? Two hangouts ago where Louis was in the Black Lives Matter room.
Yes.
As Scarlett.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and we just all started just going off.
We got really sidetracked that hangout.
Yeah.
What's that?
Did you see it? Yeah, well, Louis, who isn't here yet, I wonder if he's coming or not. But he was doing the hangout in his college campus where there's a bunch of black people around him. So they were saying stuff like, you know, we have a cross burning tonight, and stuff like that.
He was in the African American Student Union in I think whatever college he's in, and the back wall actually said like Black Lives Matter along the top, and so he got on the website and showed us.
Yeah.
At which point the entire hangout was trying to get him in trouble.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Really?
Yeah, it was just a joke.
That's funny. It's funny crap.
The thing is, at the time, I was so busy trying to like keep up with like posting stuff on Twitter and like that I was that I missed kind of what was you guys were doing. I didn't quite get it until I was listening back to it, but it's funny.
He's Chinese Protestant, man. Nothing can happen to him.
But Chinese Protestant? He's a Chinese.
What?
Oh, I thought he said Chinese Protestant.
Well, yeah, he's Chinese.
See, well, someone called him that in the chat.
No, is Chinese person defend Protestantism is what he said.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Oh, that's right. The guy was upset that all the Catholics were doing their little Catholic thing, and he went ahead and said Chinese Protestant guy defend the Protestants or something along those lines.
Yeah. So actually, I just since we have a few people here who come from an evangelical background, I mean, does anybody want to talk about that? Because I guess I'm still coming from that background myself. I feel like it didn't work out very well for me as far as helping me.
I've been studying the history of it. Do I dare go that way? Or
if, Sure,
are you still planning on writing a book or a blog post about that, Henry?
Yeah, I'm still working on that. I got a little sidetracked with some life issues, but
come on, what's more important, real life or your blog?
Yeah, I know, but you know, I got a kid. The kid's got to eat, and you know, 2 years old. They don't, you know, the child labor laws. But
come on, kids can take care of themselves.
But in all seriousness, yeah, I've been kind of looking into it, and it's kind of interesting because I think I've opined before when a lot of people today, especially in Catholic and Orthodox circles, not everyone in those circles, but some, they say Protestant, and it's kind of a loaded word. And I think if you talk to them long enough and you ask them, like, okay, what's your beef? They're really talking about evangelical theology. Because evangelicalism did break away from historical Protestantism in a lot of ways when it started coming to being.
Speaking for myself, I don't have barely any experience with any of the, I guess what you would call mainstream Reformed faiths. All my experiences with people outside of Catholicism and Orthodoxy have been with evangelicals or Baptists who are so evangelical they're not really Baptists.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And you're absolutely right. A lot of people do. That's their only exposure. Mm-hmm. And so they think that's all there is. And if they don't look into history or they're getting their history from Catholic answers, then they kind of run into hurdles there. But like, for example, some of the big changes that the evangelical movement did was, one, it introduced the concept of putting evangelism and missionary work above doctrine. Like, this is where you started to get the who cares about doctrine so long as people get saved. I mean, that mentality was going on in the middle 18th century. Mm-hmm. And this is one reason why the importance of church membership and church history started to really decline afterwards. Also, too, this is where you get a lot of the biblicists, I think is the phrase often used.
Yeah,
biblicists.
I think, yeah, you're right.
Like when people talk about me and my Bible under the tree and they try to say, oh, that's sola scriptura. No, it's not sola scriptura. However, the evangelical movement, when it kind of went away from, well, yeah, you should read the Bible, but you should also be under good teachers, you should study theology. That it started to move it towards a trend of, well, you know, you can sit under a tree, read your Bible, and bam, you've got a PhD and whatever.
It seems like the biblicists are the guys who have the creation museums with, like, the dinosaurs are, like, 5,000 years old or whatever.
Yeah, some of them do hold those kind of young earth beliefs. I wouldn't say young earth creationism and biblicism are necessarily interchangeable. However, a lot of them, they hold to that, and they hold to a lot of them are also dispensationalists, right. Amazingly enough. But that's where that's also sort of what evangelicalism introduced into Western Christianity.
Does anyone have any experience with an evangelical free? Because I'm relatively new to this church, and the reason why we start going is because, first of all, they are not tax exempt, and they openly speak about politics, which is really attractive.
Huh.
So I don't really know the difference between evangelical free, and I had experience with evangelicals because I was, you know, I basically lived with my parents up until I got married. So that was really why I went to that church.
Well, actually, it's good you bring up that question, because I think I should have brought this up earlier. I apologize. But historically,
bad Henry.
I'm sorry. Spank me later. Historically speaking, evangelicalism used to just mean Protestantism. Like, if you were to go to John Calvin or Martin Luther and say, are you evangelical? They would have said yes. But that didn't mean, that word did not have the same connotation it does today. That came later.
Yeah, but they still do. Like, Douglas Wilson calls himself an evangelical, and he's more of like the Reformed
Yeah, and in Germany, the evangelical church is when the Reformed and Lutheran churches merged together, and that's all it means is basically the German Protestant church. But like evangelical free, I don't know. I brought up the historical definition because I don't know if maybe they're going another route with the term.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with the free, you know, attachment to that. But I have been seeing a few churches with that name, so I guess I should.
I like the idea of a church refusing the tax exemption status because I like the idea of the church being a safeguard, especially when it comes to very, very important issues that kind of get overlooked, like abortion. I mean, it is overlooked.
Well, see, my church, we talk about politics, that, you know, about abortion, gay marriage and stuff. And my pastor said, you know, I'm sorry, you know, I can't, like, if you're a you can't be a Christian and be a Democrat in this time of age, is what he said.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, I would argue that you can't really be much of a Republican either.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but you get, like, you know, conservative. You have to be basically a conservative, basically. You get what I'm saying. Like a normie conservative. Maybe.
So technically, if you are 501c3, you're not supposed to talk about anything. I mean, not even. Some people think it's just endorsing candidates, but it's everything political. You're technically not allowed to. So you're basically subjecting yourself to, you know, university standards if it's a state university, or you can't, teacher can't talk about politics or anything at all.
Well, the 501c3 thing, the 501c3 process is exactly the inversion of the proper order, because now you have the church essentially asking recognition from the state.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Well, it should be the spiritual authority conferring legitimacy and authority on the head of state, not vice versa.
Right.
It's exactly wrong.
Well, what's funny is, if I recall correctly, the reason they instituted the tax exemption was for the purpose of expanding religion in society.
Yeah.
It wasn't a matter of necessarily, far as I know, I could be wrong, feel free to correct me, but it wasn't a matter of controlling religion necessarily. It was just, we want more churches in our country, so let's try to make it easier for churches to grow. The problem is now, if I get in my basement and say I worship the fish god Magoo-boo-boo-boo-boo-boo-boo, I get tax exemption because, hey, I'm a religion.
Well,
that's really kind of the problem with
I'm saying this, like, Scientology is not considered a religion in some countries with tax exempt laws. Like Germany, I think, I don't know, it's probably not, but Scientology is not considered a religion.
Yeah, it's not recognized. That was a problem when they were filming Valkyrie, World War II movie. Tom Cruise, who's a Scientologist, they wouldn't provide funding for the film because Scientology is recognized as like more of a cult in Germany, by the state, I should say, and not a religion.
Well, I think, you know, you get what I'm saying. I think it's going to be a harder process to do that, you know. You're going to start your own religion. Be tag exempt.
But I was thinking, like, if you look at the Black Hebrew Israelite crowd, which I don't know how many people are familiar with them. I mean, those guys are tax exempt.
No, but I think Scott's absolutely correct. You know, it's the claim is often made for the United States, especially with the Declaration of Independence, the idea that we're under God. But our laws don't really reflect that. And our thinking doesn't really reflect that either.
Mm-hmm.
And we have an entire situation here where with this tax exempt status, we have a knife to the throat of major churches that doesn't allow them to actually fulfill their missions. It is the responsibility of the church to stand up to the state if the state is in mortal sin.
And I also, there's another problem with this tax exempt thing. It also helps the spread of Islam, I think, too. Would you guys agree with that? Like, being more mosques and stuff?
Well, it certainly adds to it, I would say.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought of that, too. Yeah.
Wind chimes.
Wind chimes? I like chimes, actually.
Yeah, I like
sorry, I'm sorry. That's me. I'm out in the front porch of my mother-in-law's place. It
adds cool. Good background music.
They're not that loud, so it's not really like you have to mute or anything.
That's good background music. So
when the church has to go to the state and fill out paperwork to sort of be a legitimate religion, to have its priests marry and do things like that, mm-hmm. and you've got it's something that was sold to us as, hey, we want to encourage the growth of religion, and that may have been the intent among some of the folks who were for this sort of thing. But what it does is it puts the church under the thumb of the state. And you can't stand up and say to those in power, I adjure thee in the name of Christ, because they'll adjure you in the name of the IRS.
Exactly. Well, exactly.
And also, there's some like anti-Christian law. I remember this one time in Boston. They're telling us, get permits to go witness the faith, and like in some states up north, like Boston or something, because. I can't remember, but they're telling us this back when I was in high school. It was like, some, towns, get permits to actually, hand out Bibles and stuff, or you get fined.
Well, I mean, that's certainly where the future could lead.
Some states are actually doing this, actually, like some American cities, like, not Boston, but I'm talking, I was going on a Boston mission trip, they're talking about this and stuff.
Yeah, I think the situation is going to be that as long as churches are going to cling to the tax exemption status, they're going to be emasculated churches. They're going to be, they're not going to be able to fulfill their mission, really. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
It's a case of trading. It's the trade off that Esau made when you trade off your spiritual inheritance for a momentary pleasure. And you can have big buildings and big parking lots and big facilities that you probably couldn't afford if you had to pay taxes on them. So you get these big edifices that you can build tax-free. But the trade-off is you're now spiritually subservient to the state, and you're answerable to the IRS, you're answerable to Congress, you're answerable to the whims of the state. And so you've got a big building with millions of dollars and a big parking lot and all these things, but you don't have spiritual authority.
My hearing here.
Yeah, you're kind of fading out, Scott.
Yeah, I didn't really catch off that either.
Oh, okay, that wasn't just me.
The very end, you kind of started fading out. Mark, looks like you finally made it in.
I think also to it's another example of the road to hell is paved with good intentions.
Yeah.
Right? And I think it's just another example of where and this is not the first time. This has happened back with the things like the French Revolution. It's happened. I mean, there's plenty of examples in history if you wanted to pick them out, where the church chooses subordination in everything but name.
The mark of the beast.
It's kind of like, you guys ever read Galatians? Like the first few chapters of Galatians?
Is that like in the Bible?
No, it's in the book of Satan, so.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Well, then I've definitely read it.
Okay. Well, yeah, I think like it talks about naming the, the Jew kind of the beast, I guess, It's a good passage. You should read it. Like, talk about, people are trying to, mislead you guys and stuff.
Oh, yeah, those people are always, we always have those people.
Yeah.
Like all the liberal Christians today.
Yeah, basically.
So-called Christians.
Well, the one that was getting a lot of traction was what is that name? He's this horrible Jesuit that pops up all the time because he has these awful Twitter comments. But basically, he was talking about the gender and sex related.
I think I know what they're talking about. I can't remember his name.
I don't know. All the Jesuits are pretty awful right now. I mean, it's kind of a horrible legacy at the church.
Isn't the Pope a Jesuit?
Oh, you know he is.
Like, that's how I heard from another Google Hangout I was in. And I was like, I don't know much about Catholics, so the only thing I know is that my second cousin's a Catholic. I don't know family.
I mean, I just know St. Francis Xavier is rolling in his grave and Ignatius of Loyola rolling in their grave seeing what the Jesuit order has become, because they really are just horrible. James Martin, that's his name. Thank you, Testus, in the chat.
James what?
James Martin, SJ.
He's the Jesuit that Stephen Colbert has all on his show all the time, which is pretty much all you need to know about it.
Is he preaching tolerance and, you know, love is love and all this crap?
Well, I think he's a little worse than that one. He goes beyond the platitudes of the soft-hearted left liberation theology kind of stuff.
I'm sorry. Every time I hear liberation theology, I think like the sexual revolution of the 60s and stuff. For some reason.
Now we're miserable because we're free.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah.
That's kind of fun. We wanted freedom, now we got freedom, now we got nothing to do with this freedom.
You know,
well, it's not really freedom, it's more like license, isn't it? I mean, people were free before.
I know.
Yeah. Good way of putting it.
I see this all the time. The idea that George III was a tyrant is one of the most laughable things if you compare it to our current modern state.
Well, it's kind of, like, this is one of the American colonists to pay not that much of taxes, really.
Well, the funny thing is, too, when you study Revolutionary War history, a lot of people don't know this, but very, very early on, the American revolutionaries, and I'm meaning the people who were opposing the taxation and everything, they were very pro-monarchy, actually. They went, like, there was a meeting, I think it was in Boston, I want to say, I could be wrong, but they were protesting some of the taxes that had been imposed. And they actually lodged the blame at Parliament, and they sent a letter back to England attacking Parliament, but praising the King. And the King was seen as this kind of connection between the British Parliament and the American colonies. And it wasn't until you had dunderheads like Thomas Paine step in that you had people actually start to associate American problems with the King himself.
Yeah, a lot of that, though, is, to be fair, a lot of that is purely semantics. The Dutch claim they were the true servants of the King of Spain during the Dutch Revolt, and that was the most preposterous thing.
Such a Protestant, too, which is kind of funny, too.
Well, it was a more religious conflict than it was anything else, but you can't claim to be the servant of the King of Spain if you're in open revolt against him.
Well, the other thing the American colonists want was they want to be represented in Parliament, basically.
Well, it is true that in that era, Parliament was definitely more powerful than at any point in history. And since that time, since essentially the death of Charles II, Parliament has done an upward spike in power, just like any centralizing government does.
Just to be fair, what kind of power does the current monarchy of England has now?
More symbolic than anything else.
They look pretty.
That's what I thought too. I thought they had like one little bit piece of power left, like to get a vote tied or something to get a vote.
they actually do have a bit of power still.
Well, I know one thing they can have is Canada and Australia, because someone was telling me this on Sunday, but...
Scott, you're coming in low and then louder. It's kind of going back and forth.
I'm sorry. Let's see if I can find a better signal.
Well, yeah, the thing about the Crown does have some sort of power over Australia and Canada. I know that they got Gough Whitlam removed as PM of Australia back in the 70s, but that's like a very rare thing.
Yeah, but they haven't done that in Canada yet. So
if they step in and it's the wrong subject, but they don't have popular support, it's the end.
Yeah.
I think right. recently the Prince of Liechtenstein stood up for some principle, thank heavens. But I know in Belgium, the previous king, or maybe it was two kings ago, would stand up for things. They don't do that now.
Oh, Belgium has a king.
Belgium does have a king, yes.
Okay, I'm surprised.
The King of Luxembourg was deposed by the parliament for vetoing a bill on euthanasia.
Oh my gosh.
That's what you'll be referring to. That's the current, although he's not a king. What's he called?
He's the Grand Duke.
Yeah. Grand Duke, yeah, that's it. Liechtenstein's monarchy is effective almost an absolute monarchy. So
isn't the Prince of Liechtenstein has a black kid?
It's not a black kid. It's like one of his, like not the successor son, but one of his other sons is married to a black woman. It's something along that. It's not actually the person who is set to succeed him. I don't think.
Thank God.
Yeah, that was a weird event.
Yeah, I was like.
Well, there have been not necessarily royalty, but there have been. Not trying to go full Kangs on you. But one of the Dukes of Florence was a mulatto.
You're trying to blackwash history.
actually, guys, true story. The Black Hebrew Israelites claim King James of the King James Bible.
I have
was
seen
black.
That.
Yeah.
I think they said Henry VIII was black too.
There is actually a book that says the stewards were black. The Stuart dynasty were black.
Actually, King Solomon was a black. He married a black woman.
Yeah,
they say that
Frederick Barbarossa was a black guy.
They say that George Washington and Queen Victoria were also black.
They may have been black.
In fact, I'm black. Oh, wait, no.
Except with a bunch of women.
You wish.
Has there been any American princesses other than Grace Kelly?
No, I don't think that
I'm aware of.
Right,
yes. There was one. She married. She married one of the sons, a brother of Napoleon. And she was from Maryland, and she had attained quite a bit of celebrity here in the U.S. She was divorced, but still milked it for years.
I don't count that as being a princess, too.
Wasn't there a very brief king of Texas at one point?
No.
Before Texas joined
Elizabeth Patterson.
No, that was King of Bonaparte. Spain. That was King of Spain.
I remember reading something about this. Like Texas was considering becoming an independent monarchy at one point.
No, I don't think
so. They talked about that here in the United States as well before they decided to do the whole...
I don't think so, because Sam Houston, probably.
Texas was an independent country for, 9 years, though, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. I can give you all the presidents you want. Sam Houston, Lamar Houston, and... Oh, I forgot the other guy's name. Nobody likes about him.
King of Jordan?
No, it's some other guy. I forgot his name.
Didn't the Queen of Denmark recently come out and say that these immigrants need to assimilate to Danish way of life or something like that?
Yeah, yes, I think
it was a Scandinavian country, but I don't think it was.
No, it's Denmark. It's Denmark.
Was it Denmark? Okay.
Yeah, was it?
Yeah.
Little too late though, isn't it?
Yeah.
What other countries?
Well, Nat has anything to say about it.
How many European countries have a king queen still?
Like an actual effective one or just a symbolic one?
No, it's like
one?
a figurehead. I figure, royal family.
Well, Norway and Sweden do, don't they?
Sweden,
yeah. Norway and Sweden yes. do.
Denmark.
Britain, UK, Belgium. The Netherlands.
Spain.
Luxembourg, Liechtenstein.
Romania.
I can actually give you the...
Andorra has a bishop as a head of state.
It's the UK, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, Belgium, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Liechtenstein, Andorra, Monaco, Spain, Vatican City. That's it.
You said Monaco. You said Monaco, did you?
Yeah, Monaco. He said Monaco.
Oh, yeah, I thought you skipped Monaco. I was like, I'm pretty sure Monaco.
No, Monaco's in there, yeah.
Yeah, it's a principality.
Andorra, though, is not a king. It's a bishop, though, isn't it?
I think it's counting, Oh no, I thought Andorra was
like the president of France and a bishop.
But I think the bishop occupies some like civic role as well. Like the Pope is technically also the king of Vatican City. Okay. He's a king.
So how many of these countries are actually affecting public policy?
None, apart from Liechtenstein. Liechtenstein, and then Vatican City, you could count that as well.
I don't know about Monaco or Andorra. Just wait until Liechtenstein gets some nukes, man.
I don't know about Monaco or Andorra. They may...
I think Monaco, they have quite a bit of power, and Andorra they do as well. But these are very small communities, small countries with...
No military.
There's no major country as a... as an effect.
And they're all blood... I guess, chosen by blood.
Yes.
Not the Pope, obviously.
Yeah.
The funny thing about Spain, like, his ancestors are king of France. That's what I heard.
Yes, they're Bourbons. Bourbon dynasty.
So, if you want to retake the French monarchy, we can have him.
Well, Spain could have been the one example, but Juan Carlos didn't want to play that game.
Yeah.
Juan Carlos was the one that told Chavez to shut up, right?
Yeah, porque no te callas.
Yes, I love that guy.
When was this? When did this happen?
Oh, this was at a meeting of Latin countries, and Chavez had called, I think Zapatero was the Spanish Prime Minister's name. He called his predecessor a fascist.
Yeah, Aznar.
And Zapatero said, well, wait a minute. Now, I don't agree with the man's policies, but he was elected by the people. You can't call him a fascist. And furthermore, and then Chavez started to interrupt him, like he started to talk over him. And they cut off his mic, and he still kept talking. And finally, the king of Spain leaned over and shouted, ¿Por qué no te callas? Which is Spanish for, why don't you shut up?
Yeah, I know what Spanish is.
To be fair to him, just being elected doesn't mean you're not a fascist. There were
true.
To be fair to the king of Spain, t-shirts were sold.
It's all just, it's just words. Actions speak louder than words, and the king of Spain has done.
Well, that's very
nothing.
True.
So,
he hasn't done anything.
I don't consider it legitimate.
That'd be funny, though. If
they press news, I think that I'm the king of Spain, not of Belgium.
Hey, we got a question in the text chat. It says, Rooster God says, who's the guy that the Habsburg head punched for insulting the Pope? Does anyone know about this?
No, I never heard about this.
Who's the guy that the Habsburg head punched for insulting?
What, recently?
Yeah, I'm not sure. Does anybody know what this is a reference to?
Well, the Habsburgs are not allowed to claim any titles in Austria or any of the former Austrian territories.
Otto had to give up any claims in order to come back to Austria.
Yeah, I'm going to Google this. I'm going to Google this now.
speaking of the Habsburgs, though, and I think this is very good from a Christian perspective, the ceremony to enter a body into the traditional Habsburg crypt is something that I think everyone should get a chance to watch whenever they do. It's on YouTube. But basically, the presenter knocks on the door, and the monks from behind the door say, who enters? And he says all the titles of the Habsburgs, which of course takes like 5 hours.
What was the question again?
And you can't enter. And then he knocks again. Who's there? And they say just, Otto von Habsburg, King of Austria, Apostolic King of Hungary, you cannot enter. And they knock again. Who's there? Otto von Habsburg, a man. And they said, you may enter. I always found that a very powerful ceremony.
What was this now, Joshua?
It's a ceremony for interring the bodies of the Habsburgs in their crypt in, I think, Vienna. It's on YouTube. Oh. I can look it up and...
Okay. So I'll make a note of this.
I mean, just for perspective, in 1900, there were only 3 countries in Europe that were not monarchies. So it's fallen quite a way.
I don't know. So what was the question again?
Here. I found it. It's in the group chat, Ian.
Yeah.
On my phone. It says Otto von Habsburg punched the Pope, but I don't think that's right.
Otto von Habsburg?
Yeah.
Funeral?
I think you punched some works. I don't know. I'm trying to find it. So.
Habsburg funeral.
Yeah.
He's old. I wish, you know.
So I've got a question while you guys are figuring that out.
Sure.
I'm popping in and out here. For those who are American and are monarchists, how would we realistically move in that direction?
That's a good question.
I'm a monarchist, but I wouldn't necessarily put a monarchy in the United States.
Mm-hmm. It depends. Like, if Trump gets elected, then I don't mind him becoming a monarchy.
I certainly do. That's not who I would want to have as a monarch. But then
that would mean that everybody from his line would be part of our ruling system.
I wouldn't, I'm saying if Trump did do something like that, I wouldn't mind it with him. So
Trump is not going to become the monarch of the United States.
I know. I'm saying I'd say if he did. If he did, but he won't.
He can do so much better on that front. Yeah.
Well, at the very best, the most fantastical level you could possibly dream of is that Trump would be like a Pinochet. He's not going to be a king.
Oh, yeah. Caesar.
Yeah. Well, this is actually something I've kind of been, I guess, struggling with in some respects recently, because I think you can only really have a transformation into monarchy a few ways, where either you have someone like, okay, I'm just going to say, for the sake of example, not necessarily trying to prove a point, but Trump, let's say Trump decides, hey, me and my family line, we're taking over America. You need something like that, which sometimes involves a violent takeover or some sort of formation of power granted by the people. Or you need someone who is an established figurehead who can take that power, like you've seen in European history before. You need that to happen. And
Henry,
I think
you're discounting the spiritual aspect, though, of a monarchy.
Oh, definitely.
Monarchies only work because they derived their authority from the spiritual.
Well, see, I'm not even necessarily thinking from high kings. I'm thinking like, even let's talk about even before William the Conqueror era feudalistic Britain, you still had a system where people would gather around a leader and put him in charge, and usually it was his line which started to lead the people. Even if it was just local, like, you know, this town on a hill, we've got a guy in a castle, he's got an army, he protects us. You still have that aspect. Now, were there often spiritual parts to that? Absolutely, yes. And in that society, the king submitted to the spiritual aspect. So I don't necessarily disagree on there. I'm just talking about the hedge of a kingship necessarily as a country, like Britain does or Russia does. You would have to, in essence, either have someone take that power, or you'd have to have some ability to bring that back, like if we brought someone from Britain to be king of us or something.
No, you would not want to do that.
No, not necessarily. No, just theoretically. But I think we talked before, like I think we talked about this before in a previous hangout, where the possibility of the Tsar coming back to Russia, and if Putin would permit that, even if it was just in a figurehead role, not necessarily like Putin says, what the heck, who's talking?
This is classic Liu Yi.
Anyway, we talked about, you know, Putin would be able to do that, but Putin would have that power. You know, the Russian government at this moment would have had that power to do that. Well, you would have to have something like that established in America in order to do that.
And I know we were just answering Rachel's question about monarchy. I think the idea of establishing a monarchy, and I think anything really that high politically minded is kind of the wrong idea of what you want to do here in the United States. I think our sights need to be set much much closer to the ground.
Kind of like a Roman Republic almost.
No. I don't think it really matters for Christians in this country what form of government we have. I think we're pretty much out of this scenario as far as high politics is concerned.
Well,
we might be better off for it.
Well, it depends. We have communism, like a communism thing, like Russia had, killing every single Christian.
So, is it safe to assume that many of you are no voters?
I didn't.
I voted on Monday, so.
Never voted in my life.
I voted on Monday. So.
I vote because why not? Hey.
I was willing to consider Trump, but I decided in the end.
You should vote on Trump. No. You want to tag Clinton?
Lesser of two evils is still.
I voted for Trump just because I figure he's like. Well, I don't believe in democracy in general. I still feel like if you can use it to your advantage in some way, why not?
Well, yeah. You don't believe in democracy then. So you can't really do that.
I'm using it. It's not using me.
I don't necessarily
think that's the case though. You know? I mean I do understand what you're saying, and in fact I'm very sympathetic towards that. You're going to be in an entire lifetime of voting for the lesser of two evils, and you're still going to get what you have, which is an evil.
You have to look at the attitude that it's coming from.
If you don't stand up and make a difference, you won't make a difference, obviously. Sit down.
Well, and also if you don't vote at all, then you're just leaving all the votes still, the bimbos who won't vote with their feelings.
Yeah. So it's you can sit down on the ground, don't stand up, and take it, or you can fight for it. So which way do you want
to
do?
I just think your fight should be focused elsewhere. I think trying to focus your energies into that kind of forum is.
Debbie Downer.
Sorry, I'm very pessimistic.
Mommy, Daddy, please don't fight.
We're gonna take this outside.
I mean, I'm just saying, like, if it weren't for Trump, like, I wouldn't have voted probably. But I mean, like, if it's been like Jeb Bush, then I'd be like, yeah, whatever, I don't care. But
yeah,
like,
if it was Jeb Bush, I wouldn't care. If it was Ted Cruz, like, nope, I'm not voting for Ted Cruz.
Ted Cruz, I don't really think could win in general anyway.
No, he was not gonna win even before all this lying mess happened.
But Ted Cruz offended me too much with his comments about Israel when he spoke to Syrian Christians.
Oh, yeah.
Stand with the Jewish people, and I won't stand with you.
I think we lost our
guy. Crying out loud. That was something else, wasn't it?
I'm going to be gone for a second. Sorry, guys.
What?
Baby duty is right now.
All right. Good to go.
Hey, you tell that baby get off the ball and get a job.
We'll probably be gone for a while.
All right, have fun.
Thanks.
Thanks for coming.
What I usually say is if you think that, if you hold to the principle of being anti-democratic, if you think that an election could, in a cynical way, forward that agenda, then you should go and vote. Obviously checked against, intrinsic morality. Some people have said, well, if you really wanted things to change, you'd vote for the worst candidate, because that's going to make things change faster, because they're just going to destroy things. But there's also a moral dimension to that. Like, I could never vote for Hillary Clinton out of accelerationism, because I couldn't actively put my support behind somebody who believes the things that she does. But that being said, if I was in the United States and if I was voting, I'd probably go and vote for Trump, not because I think he's going to make America great again or anything like that. But certainly foreign policy areas that he has expressed a very sharp division from the rest of the political establishment on, and also the Overton window and the narrative change that has come with Donald Trump, that's worth voting. I didn't vote in Brexit, but I look back on it and think I could have voted. That didn't matter, obviously. Brexit happened. But, I look back on it and think, I didn't vote because, to me, voting is a dirty, disgusting thing to do, for me personally.
You listened to Trump's drain swamp speech.
Yeah.
Like, he's going to like, you know, basically kick every single fat cat basically out almost.
I very much doubt it. It's a, you know, well, John McCain said, build the dang fence. It never happened.
Well, people,
politicians say things.
I don't think
he's going to build a wall. I don't think that's probably going to happen. Mexico's probably not going to pay for it because he's got to get it through Congress. And Congress is full of the same people it's always been full of. Congress is not going to change in a Trumpian direction this election cycle. There are certain things he can do, but
executive action.
Executive orders,
Good executive
Obama,
action,
Obama
I guess.
Obama has done this for a long time.
Executive action is not going to build a wall, though. That's very executive actions is for really small potato kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah. Busting in illegal.
Well, they sometimes start out that way.
Like, the wall is a very expensive project. It's massive.
I know, but things can happen.
Anything could happen.
I'm just saying, anything could happen.
What I'm saying is, if you look at countries around the world where they've done a policy like that, like, look at Hungary. Hungary built a wall. They actually went and did what Donald Trump's talking about. But the difference is, in Hungary, the leader there has complete control of the judiciary, he has complete control of the legislature, he has a supermajority, he can change the constitution when he wants. He is effectively a democratically licensed dictator. Donald Trump wouldn't have that mandate in the United States because your system is so, you know, it's so sort of deliberately divided.
Yeah.
To stop things happening.
Corrupt.
Well, you know, corruption's part of it, but it's also, it's very difficult to do things in a sweeping manner unless you control key institutions, which that's what the left has been very good at. They knew which institutions to target, and once you've got them, you can change things like marriage in a heartbeat with a court ruling. But you can't do that with, you know, a wall. The court's not going to rule on a wall, and besides, you don't have the judges for it.
Well, it's when Trump, you know, puts the judges on there, will happen, so.
Well, he'll get to a point, if he gets elected, he'll get to a point, the replacements for
he's gonna
Scalia,
one.
Who's dead.
That's assuming you get the replacements through.
Then that crazy old lady, she's going to retire after Trump gets in.
You'd hope so,
Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Yeah,
Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
And that's two. And I think one of them is going to retire, so that's like three.
Well, but even so, the wall is not a decision that would be made by the court. The court's not going to say it's constitutionally mandated that we have a wall.
The court says it's constitutional, so basically you can't...
He needs the money, so he needs...
Well, I think the money
approved spending
in
the Senate to do it.
Well, the Senate's going to say yes, because... Holly.
Trump could win and the Senate could be controlled by Democrats. That's, you know, that's a very likely possible outcome.
But Democrats are going to be...
I don't know. If Trump wins, they'll probably get so many down ballot votes that they probably will keep the Senate.
Well,
I don't think Trump...
What's the current balance in the Senate? And
it's Republicans.
In key battleground states.
It's like one or two votes, right? It's very, very close.
I think it's two.
Yeah, it's like 100 senators, so... I can't remember.
Oh, I think we have the Impaler on.
Gregory Carlin.
Quick, everyone take off your hats.
Hey, guys.
Hello.
Hey, Gregory.
Hello. I just received the invitation.
Yeah. I sent it out when I invited everybody else. I don't know if maybe you just didn't get it until now or what.
My phone just notified me. It has a delay.
Oh, wow. Yeah, because I sent them out like an hour ago. So.
Sorry.
I mean, I don't know. It's like I said, Google system is kind of screwy, so who knows. Like, Mark was having trouble getting in earlier, too.
That was because of the link that I had on the email was that didn't work anymore, so I had to join it from like the little Google chat thing that comes up on the left hand side.
Okay. Yeah, so I don't know. I think Google will do a better job of making their links work or whatever. But
I think Hangouts is a cool idea, but a lot of it's kind of clunky.
It's okay. Yeah. It's better than Skype, so.
Yeah. Oh well. Of course. Yeah.
I use Skype for podcasts.
Shouting out your window is better than Skype.
Hey, Skype's okay. It depends on who has some shitty connection, like shitty signal.
Oh yeah, guilty as charged. I usually have a shitty connection.
That's why Scott left. His connection wasn't very good.
Has Gregory been on before?
Yeah. He was on like 2 episodes ago, I think.
Oh, okay. Cool.
So sweet.
Gregory's from Romania.
So you guys do this on a Romania? Weekly basis, so what?
It's my bi-weekly though. We actually spent 3 weeks since the last one because I decided to take a break last week. I gotcha. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, just we haven't heard anything from William yet. He joined a while ago, but you haven't said anything either.
Oh, I've just been trying to catch up, see where you guys were. Can you hear me?
Yeah,
he
we hear you.
Finishing his post-industrial Nazi grunge.
Of course.
Yeah, this is a no particular topic episode, so we can just say whatever. We were just talking about tax exemptions earlier and monarchy and you know, we bounced around to different subjects.
And we're going for Trump.
Yeah, now that's where I guess we're there now.
Well, you know, Trump does have this regal aura to him. It's almost undeniable. He does have this demeanor of being of the ruling elite. Although he is buffoonish, he has that style of dressing, of acting, of decorating.
People, I mean, people are not going to like me saying this, but Trump reminds me a lot of Idi Amin.
Dude, I was just thinking that. Oh my
like
God.
A white Idi Amin. He's like very, he's very he's actually like very jovial, but he can like really tear into people quite well. And
but now, does that mean Trump's going to feed people crocodiles or?
Well, I mean, if it's CNN reporters, I honestly, you know, that won't bother me too much.
I mean, if he feeds Joanne Reed to the crocodiles, I'll be okay.
You know, like, you know, Trump said he can shoot someone on 500 Avenue. People wouldn't care.
Yeah, but that's just how popular it was. I don't think he was actually saying, like, he was going to shoot someone.
I'm waiting for him to, like, mention helicopter rides.
He was still liking him if he'd kill someone, like a reporter or
something. Oh, I thought helicopter rides were already assumed, Mark.
Well, that, there's that sound out they play on TRS of him going, let's give him a helicopter ride. And cause he was actually, like, at some state fair or something where they're giving helicopter rides to people.
To
and,
kids, yeah.
That's
yeah.
Iowa.
Let's give him a helicopter ride. Maybe. On TRS, they play that drop sometimes.
See, I don't think helicopter rides are a good form of execution, to be honest.
It's about the show, not the efficiency.
That's true.
Impaling
it's
people
not the destination.
For 3 days.
I don't mind doing Peter the First and Peter the Great did in Russia, do the executions himself.
I thought you were about to say Peter the Great did the executions using helicopters. I was
No.
I know Peter the Great made certain strides for Russia, but damn, helicopters way back then, that would have been something.
Have fun, boyers.
Oh, that's bad.
Well, the whole helicopter thing was just good for getting rid of the bodies. It was good for getting rid of
back in the old days, have helicopters.
Yeah.
Was this a Pinochet thing, the helicopters?
Not just Pinochet, it was, I believe they also did it in either El Salvador or Nicaragua. There are a couple, or Honduras, that was it. They did it in Honduras as well.
Oh my gosh.
Well, that was the whole point of Idi Amin feeding people to crocodiles was to get rid of the bodies.
Oh. Yeah. Well,
it's
got to be difficult to like bury them in Africa because the soil there's not great for burying.
He's feeding pigs. Oh wait, that's a serial killer. Never mind.
No, that's what Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels. Or no, Snatch. Was it Snatch? Was a big speech about
serial killer feeding to pigs?
No, there was a famous movie speech, and I think it's Snatch where this British mafia guy is trying to scare two guys into telling him something, and he goes in this long spiel about how pigs just eat everything in sight, and he ends it with never trust a man with a pig farm.
You know, I heard someone actually did do that. Like, I don't know. I'm gonna Google this.
Yeah, it was me.
I'm gonna Google this. I'm there now.
Yeah, we had a serial killer in BC who fed his victims to it. He was a pig farmer.
See. I thought I knew it was Canada. See, it's always in Canada. You have to shoot people.
Canada.
It's always not in America. We just shoot people.
Yeah, we gotta use the pigs, eh?
Yeah, for that game bacon.
Can I offer a very a convoluted and speculative input about democracy and kingship?
No. Yes. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
It's fine.
Well, this is. I probably can vote, but I'm still a U.S. citizen, but I live in Canada. But I figure that's the inversion of taxation without representation. It's representation without taxation. So I feel like it's not really something I would do.
That makes sense.
But I mean, if you're talking about leadership as a kind of an organic reality that elites rise or essentially the president is a king that operates in 4-year or, and if he's lucky, 8-year stints and then functions kind of a, I guess you'd call it a constitutional monarchy, but a constitutional time limited monarchy in a way. I mean, even the Americans have never really, maybe back in the early days, there's been quite the kind of cult of the presidency has been developed over the last number of decades, certainly in the 20th century. Mm. And so, I mean, we have this kind of idea that if we, I am a monarchist, but I'm kind of quiet about that because it just seems so distant that it's, you know, to kind of go harp on that all the time or to, you know, say there's no participation in government until there's a king. It seems a bit twee. It's not
I agree. I mean, when I say I'm a monarchist, I don't mean I want to install a monarchy. I mean, I have a reverence for those systems of the past that we've lost. It's not necessarily a let's install this or let's completely remove ourselves until we do install that. I agree. There's room for action. I just think it's a matter of where we focus our energies.
Well, I think we have to ultimately move to longer term planning. I don't think 4-year stints are ridiculous. All that it does is offer opportunity for the rapacious. It does not offer opportunity for long term development or big view. My last blog post kind of
I think what you got to remember is that monarchy is the, or, you know, some version of monarchy at least is the default. It's the default position. It's the default setting of man. I mean, if you had, if the social systems and everything in the United States collapsed tomorrow, what kind of government system would arise, you know, in the ashes of, Houston or somewhere like that? You know, what kind of systems would arise in this type of world? Would democracies come about? Would parliaments come about? No, you'd have somebody who was powerful enough or charismatic enough or had the resources to gather enough people to them to basically enforce their will. And then they would justify that will.
Well, that's sort of like I don't know. I forget if you were here at the time, Mark, but I did bring up that, you know, in pre-feudalistic Britain, like before the Normans invaded, I mean, when you had small petty kingdoms around England, you still had people gathering around someone, you know, whether you want to call them kings or warlords or whatever, they would gather around the strongest guy and he would reign.
Yeah.
You know, even if it was a, you know, a small village on a hill, it's like, okay, we've got this guy in a castle, he's got an army, he protects us. And we submit to him and his family. And that's just how it naturally works.
Well, it's like you guys watched The Walking Dead. I don't watch it that much, but it's like, you know.
I was just going to mention that. Yeah.
Yeah, King Rick. Walking Dead. Yeah. The Walking
King
Dead.
Rick, yeah.
Yeah. Like, as a society class, is to choose some guy that's charismatic or the strongest to be the leader, basically.
And he's unwilling, too, in a way. He doesn't want the job, and he rejects it at some point.
Like the governor, for example, he was a good leader, to be honest.
You'd struggle, I think, to think of a post-apocalyptic type fiction that does not feature quasi-monarchy or quasi-dictatorship. I mean,
it's the road, and that's because there's just nobody.
Has anyone here played the Fallout games?
I've played one. That's about it. I played New Vegas.
Yeah, like if you play Fallout New Vegas, you essentially have these two factions. You've got the NCR, which is the New California Republic.
NC's region.
Which is Yeah, which is basically sort of like a rebirth of modern America and that whole corrupt system. And then you've got Caesar's Legion, which is basically a rebirth of the Roman Empire. And it's funny because I think I might have played it before I was red-pilled, I forget. But looking on it now, I'm like, you know, this is sort of like history combating itself almost. And yeah. If you were to ask me today, who would I side with? I'd be going around saying true to Kaiser, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's my Mr. Fox came from. So it was part of that game. Like my IV used to be Ropus, that Fox guy.
Oh yeah, wait, I think I've seen your avatar.
But I changed it to like something from Zelda for Halloween.
No, but yeah, you used to have the yeah, it's true to Kaiser, like that guy.
No, like no, the degenerates or something, you know. Like
oh, you sick degenerates.
I was gonna put you on a cross and shit.
And the I mean, if you look at Mafia, the organization, I mean, they are clearly little
that's a good example of monarchy, isn't it, on a
small scale. I mean, it's not democratic. There's one person who leads and
inherit. Usually it's by blood, isn't it?
Yeah, with honor and power, and it's based on blood. Yeah. Exactly. I mean, the sort of things they trade in are usually vices of some kind, because that's the markets that are easy to exploit. But there is an honor code, and there is, and it's deadly serious.
Oh, we can start a micronation and become a monarchy. Here's pick.
I think it was Vilfredo Pareto made the observation that wealth helps to breed democracy, and then democracy destroys wealth. It's kind of this sort of, it's its own grave digger. And so I think, you know, you look for the system to just sort of eat itself. And then after that, what do people do when the situation is sort of more of a live or die situation? They tend to, in much greater numbers at least, gravitate towards strong leaders rather than ideologies or ideas. And you can even see this outplaying in the American election. People feel today more sort of insecure and uncertain about the future than they ever have done. And what's the candidate that they're rallying? It's not a candidate with, you know, really coherent ideological platforms in the same way that you might think of like National Review or, you know, the old guard William F. Buckley conservatives. Trump's not really about ideology. It's about him. It really is. And you can see this on the down ballot races, where a few candidates for House and Senate tried to sort of imitate the Trump platform and unseat people like Paul Ryan, etc. And they didn't do very well. And I think that sort of goes to show that it isn't really the ideas that are motivating people. It's Trump the person. It's Trump the man.
Trump and the brand.
The political climate we're in lends itself to that kind of leader. It's, you know, you could even say it's why Vladimir Putin is very popular in Russia, because the situation is uncertain. People aren't interested in democracy. They're not interested in liberal sort of high ideas. That they're interested in strong leaders who are going to you know, keep them fed, keep them safe, and fight the people beyond the borders.
Well, I think on this
Sorry, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, I think a lot of these things are cyclical. You know, talk about monarchies and then, you know, democracies. I don't know if you're familiar with Giambattista Vico, but I think it was in the New Science, he talks about cyclical historical ages. There's like theological ages that kind of go into aristocratic ages and becomes democratic ages, and the cycle begins.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm very sort of well cool.
Yeah,
well, even, stuff from Evola.
I think we're kind of in that period where that end of the democratic stage, and we're going into possibly. Well, we're still ending it, but the next
heading into Dwapara Yuga, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, even some ancient Greek philosophers saw that. Like, I shared a quote on my blog. I forget the guy's name though, but he talks about history of one of the, I think it was, might have been Athens or one of the Greek cities, but he talks about how they would go through these trends where you'd have a guy in charge, and then he'd get a little bit too power hungry. People would overthrow him. There'd be an aristocracy. They get too power hungry. The people overthrow them. You'd have mob rule. And then they get tired of the chaos, and they gather around one guy, and the whole cycle would start up again.
At least Polybius is one of the guys who does this. He's actually talking about the Roman constitution, in particular, I think, in book six.
Louis, you sound like Max Headroom again.
Oh. Is this better?
No.
No?
Not yet.
Well, I don't know what's with my computer. Sometimes it just does these things, it seems.
It's been assimilated by the Borg.
I should watch some old Max Headroom. I haven't seen it for...
It's because I'm Oriental.
You're an automaton.
Domo arigato, Mr. Roboto.
Get out of my face, you Jap.
Classic Japs. I love how Paul calls them nips.
What did that even... do I want to know?
I'm sure it's a wartime term, yeah.
Yeah, all these ethnic slurs, like, do I even need to know the origin of them? Or like,
Are any of you familiar with RK selection theory?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm familiar with it. I've heard of it from Bill Whittle from conservative internet channel?
PJ Media.
Yeah, PJ Media. Yeah, he has a very good video on that. Like, if you want to check it out, let me see if I could find it.
So basically, maybe we should consider the possibility that this cyclical pattern of behavior is built into creation and it's unavoidable.
That's one thing I wanted to ask, because I've noticed that most rightist conservative people and most Christians throughout the ages had a cyclical view of history. They believe that things went through a cycle. Am I right?
Yeah, you are. That's very old, actually. That goes all the way back to Indus Valley civilization. Very old.
Like, in theological, in fancy theological terms, that would be called amillennialism.
So, basically, the two greatest challenges, you have two types of challenges for men of any age. You either are in the ascent of your civilization, so you have to struggle with traditional hardship like poverty and the elements. And the second is when you are rich, to resist decadence and temptation. Mm-hmm. You're either one of these two. Regardless of what period you are in history, you're either one of these two people.
That reminds me perfectly of the Puritans, like how, like, when they first came over here to settled in New England, how like they were first struggling with the environment, struggling with the nature, and had a high mortality rate, yet after they've worked hard and accumulated a lot of wealth, after three generations they became like liberal Unitarian Universalists.
And that's the basic point of being Christian. You can't cheat the system. You can never achieve utopia. Once you have the poverty solved, imagine what a relief it must have been to finally solve poverty. And we have other problems. You'll always have more problems. You'll solve one and you'll get two, because the system is made on a fallen earth. So you'll never be, in the Nietzschean sense, you'll never be an Ubermensch and perfect and have a utopic society.
It's an endless oscillation between rise and fall.
A lot of the liberal theologies in general is that they try to rig the system. They try to make essentially an unchristian perspective of Christian doctrine.
Yeah.
And it's very dangerous, because when you, it's, I think abundance is more dangerous for your soul than poverty.
Yeah, I totally agree. Yes.
And not just our dangerous for your soul. I mean, look at demographics. It's dangerous for you just physically.
Yeah. And we are built our soul. If you truly believe that your soul exists and it resonates with your society, that's why you're unhappy. Even if you're clean, even if you're a good Christian, you feel deep, deep, unrelenting pain because you see the things happening around you, and you can never be truly happy because of that.
That's true.
Yep.
Enjoying them, you have to save your soul, so you're tortured by this state, and you can't act. You're the evil one in their eyes.
Yeah, exactly. And I think people would rather be tortured by the elements than the state. Yeah, I generally don't think that wealth is necessarily correlated in any high degree to depression or self-perception.
Well, money is the greatest of all evers. Remember that?
Yeah.
Not money.
Evers?
It's the love of all money that's the root of all evil.
Love. See, love. Sorry.
Cupidity.
Well,
it's... Sorry.
Who do you think was happier? Let's say a peasant lady in the 1000s, was on a farm, whose husband was a farmer and had 9 kids and had to do the washing by hand and everything like that, or someone like Ellen Pao, chairwoman of Reddit, you know, sitting in her squeaky clean office, childless, just an old crone.
It's absolutely. Have you ever? This is a stupid question. I'm not gonna ask it. But when you go into the forest and your senses just activate, you feel like you're living at 70% of your being in the city. And when you go into an environment, you just explode with your senses. It's that refreshing to live a life close to nature.
Yeah, I haven't been able to do that recently. Just because of my situation, but I'd love to go back to the big forests.
Gregory, right? Have you ever went to church camps as a kid?
No, that's more a Protestant thing. Orthodox don't have church camps, really.
No, but I remember on a previous hangout, you were talking about how you were raised by like Baptists.
Yes. We have it's not technically a camp. We have a ski resort in my native town, so we went there. It was not a special designated camp. We just rented a few cabins and went with the church there.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I mean. Yeah, it's definitely like if you go out into nature, it's a totally different world than the city. You know, the city is just completely depressing. You know,
We have a local. Sorry. Go on.
No, I was just going to say, I think modern cities are more depressing than ancient cities were in many ways. Just partly due to the layouts of them and the way that they are very mechanical, almost as if they're built for machines because they're built with efficiency in mind. Whereas I was talking about this with Babylonian Hebrew actually on a little while ago discussing how still cities are laid out in the Middle East in places like Syria and in certain parts of Israel. And he compared Jerusalem to Tel Aviv, and like Tel Aviv is hell. Tel Aviv is like a model of like a Western city, but Jerusalem's obviously so old that it's still modeled on all of these, you know, the roads are not straight in a grid pattern. They wind all over the place. They go uphill, they go downhill. You know, that's how old cities were built. And we said that today, if you're a city planner, and you're building your city and you come across a hill, your immediate thought is, how can we destroy the hill so that we've got a flat plain? Whereas, you know, 1,000 years ago, you couldn't really do that realistically. So you're like, okay, how are we going to build around this hill? How are we going to incorporate the hill into the city? And it's a remarkable change that has gone through, and it's just part of the declining aesthetics that surround us and lead to unhappiness, certainly, in many ways.
Yeah, and also, I could speak from experience because I've been to Israel, and I've out of all the cities I liked the least, it was Tel Aviv.
Oh, it's great. It's like San Francisco. It's like
it's like Santa Monica.
It's full of gays.
Yeah, it's Sodom in the right in the heart of the middle.
Try living in Sicily.
I get a bunch of gay Jews.
Taormina. Yeah,
I guess that's the result of that.
It's funny. It's funny how bit by bit science is catching up to God. There's an old saying that scientists are climbing the mountain of knowledge for thousands of years, and at the top they find theologians. So Mr. Mark mentioned that it makes you unhappy. It actually makes you unhappy in a scientific and measurable way. In fact,
I think Mark was talking about this on his last hangout with Adam Wallace about singularity, how we will never be able to reach it, kind of like the same way we are, will never be able to reach full liberalism.
Oh, yeah. A true communism.
It eats itself. It's a system that eats itself. It's its own gravedigger, like I said.
Yeah.
You technologically advance to a point, and then at that point, the technology is so widely available and so powerful and so destructive that combined with the fallen nature of man, you simply end up destroying everything you built.
I think that's the natural way of things. I think the Amish are the most happiest people on the planet.
I wouldn't know about that. I've been to Amish country. They're going
to... Well, they all on Prozac.
I said they don't look happy, but I'm going to be an Amish and mess with all this technology,
Well, one thing you can say is they have a very high retention rate.
Well, I was going to say, on a kind of related note to our modern era, the common thing for a lot of parents is to kind of throw electronics at their kids, jump the Xbox, like and...
I was like that, to be honest.
I've really been trying to avoid that with our daughter. So, I'll tell my... Partially because I saw she was getting too attached to it. Like, you let her play with the phone for a few minutes, and then you try to pull it away. She freaks out, has a tantrum. And I'm like, okay, that's it, honey. No more. I say to my wife, don't let her play with the phone anymore. And we try to minimize that. If she's sick, okay, whatever, let her relax. But... some of the things I see her do when she does not have something she can just stare at is just amazing. Like earlier, she was taking some of her dolls and taking them grocery shopping or pretending they were going to work or something. I mean, she was using her creativity and she's doing it with items around it. And it's funny, if she doesn't have a toy or item that matches what she needs, like a microphone, she has a toy microphone. But if she doesn't have that, she'll grab something similar, like a kaleidoscope, and pretend that's a microphone.
Yeah.
And just little things like that, where she is forced to be creative, she's forced to interact with the world around her.
Yeah.
You don't have that when you have technology in essence do it for you.
And it's amazing that you know almost intrinsically on instinct that it's bad for them. Like you'll see them and if they've been on the phone for an hour, you'll say, I better take that away from them. Yeah, you wouldn't say that if it was like somebody playing with a ball or a hula hoop. You'd never say, wow, they've been playing with that hula hoop for a while. I better take that away. That's enough time with the hula hoop for now. We put it in a different category just on instincts. I think we know that at a certain level, when it's not held in moderation, it is actually very bad for children. And
even me as a grown adult, sometimes I say to myself, okay, I need to put the iPhone away and let me just read. Now, granted, I'm getting my Kindle out to read. Maybe there's irony in that.
Oh, that's so much irony.
But with my Kindle, see, I've got one of those.
As long as it's offline.
You heathen. Get a book.
But I have one of those Kindles that is just purely reading. It's not one of the super fancy Kindle Fires. It's just pure words.
I'm pretty sure you're playing something like what was the game you mentioned earlier?
He's on like Splatoon or Temple Run.
he's playing Dishonored,
Yeah.
Dang it, you've caught me.
When I was a kid, the console was for everyone. It was a game console for everyone. It wasn't in our wildest dreams that we'd have a games console all our own in our own room to play. The games console was in my mum and dad's room where we got to play it like an hour before bed, and there were three of us sharing it. So
my room.
I don't know whose idea it was to give a console to each child, but that just seems really ridiculous to me.
Someone who could get the shekels, obviously.
Clearly.
Mm. Yeah, well, you got to, because like they don't do multiplayer's all gone now. It's all, you know, you, if you want to play online with other people, you play online. Like you've, I kind of, this is so sort of like modern and materialistic, but I kind of miss the idea of just sitting around there with all the four wired controllers plugged in, and you're all actually like there playing it.
Yeah.
Like no more. Never happens.
I kept looking at my friend's screen.
Screen looking. You're screen looking.
That's talking out of that whole
time. That was a great thing. So
they still play Mario Kart with
Mario Party.
Mario Kart.
Mm.
Super Smash Brothers.
Yeah.
Ken Griffey Jr. Baseball.
Well, you know, speaking of the shekels, Lou, the problem with a lot of games currently is that they really do prey on parents, because parents are completely ignorant of what they're paying for.
Well,
it's more than that, I think. It's
there's like, you know.
No, I think there is some don't care, but I think a lot of it is parents have no idea what they're buying.
My parents didn't
do
buy very many of these things.
They have ratings. They have a rating system.
Yeah, but no parents look at the rating system.
I don't mean just like the rating. Like, I'm sure, you know, some zombie game is something a parent would want a kid to play, but it's other things like microtransactions, you know? I mean, I don't think parents really understand the implications of, you know, hop on Candy Crush until they get that bill.
Yeah, I'm sure that's happened more than a few times. Kids charging things to their parents' credit card, and
yeah, I had a niece that did that once. She was like, "Look what they're giving me."
Yeah, because it's all just so wired in. It's also integrated all the different systems now. Whereas I think previously, sort of video games were okay. It was on one system. You plugged it into the TV. You played it. That was it. You know, it didn't connect to the internet. I mean, there was no damn internet, really. Apart from that horrendous dial-up with the tone.
You wouldn't want that coming out of your TV. That was a fun tone.
But, I mean, whose idea was it to have it actually sort of play that sound? Did that sound need to come out of the speakers? Was that necessary?
Yeah, because like, you get a phone call.
It's just like...
I don't know. There's a lot of things I just don't get. Like, I want to know who's letting Hillary Clinton come up with some of the slogans she has. Remember when she said prompt up, trickle down economics?
Well, I don't think anyone's letting her come up with it. I think somebody else came up with it.
No, that was in a room somewhere. They thought that one out ahead of time.
No, actually, there's a liberal talking point, actually. People were saying that for years, like trickle down economics. That's been a liberal talking point.
Yeah, trickle down.
I think it was originally Reaganomics. Like, yeah, I think originally Ronald Reagan, and liberals caught on to it and used it to kind of mock the conservative free market economics.
Yeah, the
free market economics is not.
The trickle down economics part isn't new, but the trumped up part in front of it was the line that she had prepared
for one of the. Oh, yeah.
The leftist show.
Which is a question I wanted to ask about, like, I know traditionally rightists are not, like, super free market like American rightists are.
Nope.
So,
well, not capitalist
rightists in the first place, of course they're not.
America's never really had an authentic right.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, you've got to remember when liberalism got started, it was very much capitalistic. That socialism, dualism, and things of that nature, it supported those things like guild unions over corporations, you know, traditional local institutions, as opposed to, well, what were then sort of mercantile, which I guess were sort of state corporations. It was when the state kind of used, well, you could say the state used the corporation, or in the end, I think in many cases, the corporation actually used the state, like the British East India Company got very rich using the British military.
The trust, like, in 1900s. American politics.
Mm.
Yeah, because the reason why I'm asking is because I go into Facebook groups all the time, Christian conservative groups, and they're all like libertarian and free market leaning. They're very
yeah.
And I think I think, this is my own opinion, I think this the government should put in check with the free market, but I think, you get what I'm saying? Like, we have all these the government should enforce antitrust laws. You get what I'm saying?
Well, I think that the general rightist position, just to kind of put it forward from, say, the perspective of somebody like Otmar Spahn, who was actually a teacher of Hayek, but was a traditionalist type pre-mercantile economist himself. The idea is that capitalists are correct to say that the state manages economies poorly. Centrally planned states are very poorly run. Bureaucracy is bad. It stifles economies. The government generally can't do many things competently. This is just the nature of centralization. But similarly, the
centralization and alienation.
Let this guy finish.
But similarly, socialist, or you know, you might call it Marxist critique of capitalism, is correct in one sense in that capitalism, free, open, completely open markets have negative externalities. That would be like. If a market reaches what's called a Pareto optimum, which is where there are no further trades that can be done in the market that will make anybody better off without making somebody worse off, that's a Pareto optimum. That's a perfect market. But even in that situation where everything is done absolutely efficiently, there would still be negative externalities. So things that the market graph or whatever doesn't take account of. A good example of this would be like... the exchange of populations between nations, right? If you need a labor force to do something and you want it done cheaply and the people in your current nation, you know, want too much money to do the work, you bring people in from Mexico. Now, on the accounting books, that looks great. You generate more profit. But the accounting books don't take account of the social impact of bringing in that new people. So that what the traditionalist economist says of, you know, from the point of view of what they call purposive economics is there should be systems, not necessarily government, but there should be systems in place to take care of those negative externalities, institutions baked in attitudes, cultures, mores, etc.
Mm-hmm. See, I think I'm a traditionalist economist now because I agree with what Marx says. Like if you have, I'm trying to ruin his quote, but when you overproduce something, it becomes worthless.
Yeah.
That's the only thing I agree with Marx. He was right about that. Because my parents, you know, I lived through that stuff. Hmm. And it's like, you overproduce something, but it becomes so worthless. Because...
Yeah. But yeah. Isn't the point
I live on a dairy, and basically... All the people saying, you know, well, you're overproducing. We have to put some back. Yeah, the reason why we're overproducing is because we don't give crap. Like, we don't give very much for milk. So we have to keep on producing a lot more milk to get more money.
Well, here's.
It's over a total. It's also a negative effect in the economy because it's too much milk in the market, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think. A lot of American conservatism is strongly influenced by the Protestant work ethic, you know.
Well, also like, influenced by Ayn Rand, too.
Ayn Rand.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But, Ayn Rand. I mean, wasn't Ayn Rand kind of a newer influence?
Well,
yeah, she's
20th century influence.
Thomas Jefferson wrote about the dream of an agrarian America. So no, the work ethic and the self-made man image was there from day one.
Well, I'm talking about I'm talking about modern times. Like,
the problem.
To be honest, though, the Jefferson.
Well, I'm talking about politics.
I mean, like Ayn Rand, so modern, and also like the whole tradition of like pull yourself up by your own bootstrap, and the Protestant work ethic have been in America since the very beginning.
Yeah. And that's why conservatives in America are so free market when compared to those in Europe. It's the basic Saul Alinsky rules for radicals. You use their rules against them, so they want fairness, even though they have to stay poor. It seems fair to you that you should get what you work for.
Is that the reason why like they've lost on like social issues like pornography, because they have like a commitment to the freedom of speech or free markets.
Oh, yeah. No, it's not. They don't have wolves at the door, basically. It's very easy to forget the decline that can happen when you don't witness it. You can live in America for an entire human lifetime and not be inconvenienced once. So you lose track. You lose that fear. Yeah. That stench in your nostrils, it stays with you once you see it, and then you become conservative with everything.
Mark was saying something. What did you want to say?
Sorry.
I was just wanting to say that I think there is an intrinsic side to the decline of America's social values, in that if you take something like the prohibition on sodomy, which existed, I believe, from the start of the Republic, so they would have inherited that from the British law.
Right.
It was, yeah. And that was the case. And obviously the founding fathers who wrote the Constitution did not consider the Constitution to protect the right to do that. But the very sort of principles surrounding the Constitution would inevitably lead to it, because it's the logical it is the logical conclusion, the logical outcome. And this is where conservatives are wrong. The Constitution really is a living and breathing document, because it's based on a set of ideas that are taken to an extent, and the first group of people to implement those ideas only took them so far, but it only requires, you know, successive generations to take them further and further and further. And women's suffrage, again, the idea that all people are created equal, all men are created equal, well then, you know, if all men are created equal, why can't you say that all men and women are created equal? Why can't you say that all the races are created equal, and, you know, you have to liberate the blacks and let them vote? And it snowballs. Once you've denied the initial idea that...
Can you interpret, basically?
Yeah, the interpretation will just inevitably become more liberal. And weirdly enough, it seems that at least one of the founding fathers actually knew this. I can't remember which one it was. It might have been, I think, maybe Ben Franklin, who said, it will, you know, this Constitution will fail like all those before it.
I think there was, Thomas Jefferson said something. Maybe it was another father.
It was Jefferson. Give it a revolution.
Yeah.
Years.
He said that pretty much our Constitution is meant only for a moral and religious people.
Yeah. It'll serve no other. But what I think somebody should have asked him is, what if you say that it was only designed for a moral and religious people, that assumes that there exists such a thing as an immoral and irreligious people. And if that exists, then you have to ask the question, well, how did you end up with a moral and religious people instead of an immoral and irreligious people? And he would have had to answer that was a product of British society. It was the product of all the things like the state church, the aristocracy, the monarchy. And you took those things out, kicked them out from under it, and it eventually just decays. It dies.
The United States Constitution also makes pretty strong assumptions about its citizens. It makes assumptions that people will be informed. They'll be caring. They'll care about what they're voting for.
Well, that's what they have to tell you, college, because the people would know we wouldn't care.
And they never even possibly imagined the level of population we've achieved. Like, they just would never have envisioned.
It's a little like the magic dirt thing. They think that people are just moral and religious normally. So
the funny thing too is that none of the founding fathers really envisioned the sort of democracy we have today, where you have everybody in the country voting for a president.
Even the dependents.
Yeah, I mean, that was the point of the Electoral College, was they decided who ran the country. You didn't put it into the hands of Joe Schmo America to go out in November on a cold morning and decide the fate of the world. Majority of founding fathers, to my knowledge, were deathly opposed to that kind of democracy.
Mm-hmm. And weren't the people better then? Because they just had 2 centuries. When was America discovered? In the 1600s?
It's not even the
1600s.
1612, was it not?
Oh, they claimed the continents. They just think...
15... Oh, wait. Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492.
1492,
see.
Right.
So
you made Rachel leave.
Columbus was 1492. Jamestown was 1607.
My point was that they just tamed the continent, so of course they were hardy and moral and religious. The founding fathers just looked around and assumed, "Oh, this must be the American people." They didn't take into account the decline of wealth and decadence.
Well, I think they also overestimated their own morality.
Here's kind of a question relevant to this topic. Has anyone here read the Anti-Federalist Papers?
I've heard them.
That's actually, they're worth reading. I've been wading through them, and I'm not going to say that they all make valid points, but basically, when they were formulating the Constitution, you had the Federalist Papers, which were publications in favor of the Constitution. And then you had the Anti-Federalist Papers, which were written opposing the new Constitution.
So who wrote those?
And I know that Patrick Henry actually wrote some of them. I forget the other gentleman who made it.
Oh, really?
But when you read them, some of the arguments they make, I mean, it's like they could see into the future. And one of the things I was reading lately, Sam, can you mute your microphone?
Okay, sorry.
No, it's fine. I heard like a loud clicking noise. No, one of the things they were talking about was they were saying, look, the sort of democracy you want only works on a smaller scale, like statewide or citywide. And they said it wasn't going to work nationally. And
it's like Marxism.
One of the things they said was that you would in essence have two kinds of candidates who would be able to run for president. You would either have a person running on a very populist platform or someone who adheres to the rules of the political elite. And I was reading this and I thought, wow, someone predicted our current election. But I mean, even some back then could not foresee this form of government lasting. And we're bringing up some of the same contentions that we're bringing up now.
Well, you can also point this out to the election. What year was the corrupt bargain in?
What corrupt bargain?
What year was that? Is that the War of Eight? It's like Andrew Jackson.
1824, you mean?
When John Quincy Adams and Andrew Jackson.
Yeah, that's 1824. When the election went to the state, the House of Representatives.
Yes. That's what Patrick Henry was kind of predicting, you know? Because John Quincy Adams was the political establishment and Jackson was the populist candidate. And Henry Clay is like, you know, vote for Adams.
Yeah.
You know? That's what I'm feeling that Paul Ryan would do.
That is what we're attempting with the angry mob.
Like, you guys think it'd be another corrupt bargain if Trump doesn't make it to 270 or Hillary makes it to 270?
Well, that's what a lot of the Never Trumpers are trying to do with McMuffin.
Well, I'm talking about with Hillary. Okay. If Hillary doesn't get 270 and Trump doesn't get 270, they're going to put McMuffin in office.
No, not necessarily get McMuffin in office. It doesn't matter who is running. But if
they'll put Paul Ryan in.
And they get the math correct, it'll go to the House and they'll choose somebody from the House or the Senate.
No. I think it has to be some kind of law against that.
There isn't.
That's the law.
You know, it's to tell you.
It's not a naturally occurring.
You know, that McMullen guy is kind of shady.
Well, I think he has a lesbian mother, too. I heard he has lesbian mother that came out.
He had...
I mean, beside that, but...
Clinton, like, a while ago to do with Tony Rezko as well. I saw the papers. I think they were from WikiLeaks.
And also about WikiLeaks, like, this is back from the Hillary topic, you know, about making her campaign slogans or something. It takes 8 people to make a tweet happen.
Yeah, Trump just does his own, which is...
Yeah. It takes 8 people from her campaign. Oh my gosh.
It is interesting about the McMullen question is whether or not he's going to take votes from Trump.
Be only in Utah, though.
It only matters.
It's Utah.
Well, it's Utah, just sort of like problem.
Utah, the Mormons.
But it means that Trump, that she may take that state because the votes are coming.
Oh no, she wouldn't. There's no threat of her taking the state. No, it's either Trump or McMullen.
This is Trump winning. McMuffin and here we are tied.
I swear to God, if the Moomins vote for McMuffin, I'm gonna kill somebody.
But they seem. But she. They, I think they're,
you're gonna punch.
I think he's taking votes from Hillary more so than Trump.
Yeah.
Because if you look at the conscience of the Mormon, right, he's like trying to figure out, and some have decided, okay, well, their conscience is to vote. And then their conscience is, okay, who's the most Mormon-esque, you know, person we can vote for? We don't have Romney this time.
No, let's just vote for this CIA spook. Let's just vote
for him. Yeah, but I think it's instead of voting for Hillary rather than instead of voting for Trump.
Has anyone here been following like the tweets from Malik Obama? Those have been great.
Yeah, they're pretty great. But now he's griping about becoming verified on Twitter. Like, I had to show ID to become verified on Twitter, but I don't show ID to vote in the election.
Yeah, I was like, he could probably fix all the problems in Africa. This guy, his shit posting abilities are that good.
I think, yeah, at first I thought it was a fake account, you know, but until he posted a picture of himself or that check, I was like, oh, this guy has to be real.
Oh man,
my first thought was like, this has Trump to be a parody account.
Trump had him as a guest at the last debate, right?
To be honest,
he's like,
he tweets
several times like, this is Malik and Twitter won't verify me because I'm Kenyan.
Oh, like, I'm Obama's brother. Here's my ID. I see, like, here's a YouTube video of me.
Oh, and he's put up, I do not trust this McMullen. He is for war and killing and gay marriage. This is bad. Be good, Utah.
Really?
It's starting to remind me. He kind of reminds me of the Iron Sheik in some regards. Like, the way the Iron Sheik posts.
Do you mean the wrestler, or is that some kind of Twitter?
Yeah, the wrestler. Yeah, he'll post just random things that he's... It's actually, I think, a buddy of his that runs the account, but it's based off things he actually says in real life. So it'll be like, I'm sorry Nelson Mandela died. F Monday.
Oh my god. F Monday.
America always lectures Africa about elections, but this election looks rigged. Vote Trump anyway.
Yeah, I saw that.
Do not cheat Colorado or New Hampshire. I will know and I will be mad. And like, you might read that and think it's trolling, but this is, I've watched interviews with African leaders. This is actually how Africans like talk. They do have this kind of like,
it's why we need Africans to talk in the Anglican communion.
Yeah. Somebody did tell him what's Pepe in Harambe. Like, somebody actually did explain to him what they are and stuff, which is funny.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he did a tweet about Pepe. I can't remember what it was. That was something like, Hillary hates Pepe. How can you?
He's a wrecked Nazi. Oh, my gosh. I wish Malik... It seems like a parody account there, if you think about it.
How's it spelled? Okay. What's the...
It's at Obama Malik.
Oh, at Obama Malik. I believe I haven't.
Since Obama's brother.
I don't know if you follow Spooky Doze, but he pretty much retweets every single thing Malik Obama posts. It's pretty hilarious.
I always thought, like, the first thing I saw that tweet, like, this has to be a parody account. This is the first time I saw it.
It's just like, right, it's just like his profile picture is just.
It's a Kenyan with all. And he's like full blood, you know. It's not like look at the picture on his thing. You know,
he's from
dark, and Obama looks like a Mexican or something.
You heard the conspiracy theory that Malik and Obama are not real brothers. Like, Obama had another dad, like a
Oh yeah, Frank Marshall Davis. Yeah.
And so they're not even half. They're not even half brothers.
Yeah.
To be fair, Obama doesn't look like any of his brothers.
I know. It's weird.
Because he was created in a lab.
No, he wasn't.
He's 3D Obama printed.
No, he was. I saw it.
Yeah, he was. I
was there.
I sure it was not a meth lab experiment.
Yeah, no, man. It was a mess hall.
It's incredible. We got a full house here. We almost never get a full house in these things.
We got 12 live viewers too, Ian. It's
nice.
Oh,
yeah. Second trip to join us.
We had 7 forever. Like,
oh,
for...
yeah.
Sweet.
I'll say this though, even though we only have like 10 or so viewers each time we do this live, the chat is usually goes pretty good.
Yeah.
Well, who cares with the viewers, man? We're just having fun.
Well, it gets like what, 500 or so views, Ian, per hangout?
That's pretty good.
Some, I mean, more. There's one here where this number 16 had 761 views.
Oh, I must have been on that one.
Have you guys played a drinking game during debates?
No, I've never.
I did it the first debate. I was like, I can't do this.
Degenerate?
I did it for one debate. It was a very
The first group debate was painful. It was horrible. The second was good, and the third was painful and horrible.
I was drinking.
I missed the second debate because of the hurricane.
No, the second debate was good because of the because you'd be in jail.
Yeah,
the third one wasn't that bad. The third one was bad. Trump won the third one, barely, but the first one was terrible. But I was drinking, so.
Well, the speed. I he's very different in the debates than he is, because then he'll go off and give these like crazy speeches. Like the day after, or just in the afternoon. I mean, the stuff that followed the third debate was crazy. Gettysburg address, and then that Catholic charity, can't remember the name of it, the Catholic charity speech, where he's supposed to go and pretend everything's cool between them, and he just carries on. She's corrupt. She's corrupt. The stuff he said, has anybody watched that?
I've watched part of it.
I watched part of it.
The most memorable part was when he said like something about Hillary pretending to not hate Catholics, and the entire crowd full of Catholics booed him.
It's
in most of the audience were echoes, you know, as Putin.
Yeah, a lot of them were Skypes. Yeah.
Skype.
Are you talking about like did they digitally put that in or something?
Well, no, they literally were. Goldbergs and Shekelsteins and
including the bishop.
You know, they had like Cardinal Shekelstein there, and it's kind of.
I got a question. Yeah. What was the charity for the Catholic charity?
Not looking to get into the JQ thing.
Was it the Catholic charity for children?
We started this hangout with the JQ thing, so it might as well.
Yeah.
Is that Duke Green? My new fast food chain.
Was it the Catholic charity for Syrian children?
The Auschwitz dinner is what you're talking about?
Yeah, was that the charity for?
That was such a despicable display. As a Catholic, I was kind of upset that Cardinal Dolan started the whole thing out with saying that she needed to apologize. Never got an apology out of her. And then she's sharing the speech with this woman who is in favor of infanticide.
Yep.
See, if I was a bishop, I would look pimp slapper, basically. He's like, you better apologize, you say a bunch of bad words, you know?
Joshua, I forget. Did you see that Twitter conversation I got with the liberal Catholic?
Are you talking about the John Curve guy?
I forget the name. I thought it was a girl.
Like,
but
he was talking about like liking Marx and things like that.
No, I don't remember.
Holy
that
crap! That might be the guy that I had.
Young John Court. Is that his name? Is that what you're talking about, Mark?
That guy's a. Well, no, I won't say.
He calls himself a Catholic.
Oh, no, actually, no, I will. That guy's a fucking psycho.
Yeah.
He couldn't even argue anything. He was just like saying, he even at one point admitted, oh, I can't actually argue very well, but you are pagan scum.
Well, neither can I.
His response to everything was like, oh, you don't agree with me? Well, F you. That's his entire.
I saw that. Yeah.
Yes.
Everyone who disagreed with him was a pagan. And then he said, he had some other hangers on who were coming into the debate. One of them said something like,
I'm the one true Christian.
It was something like,
He's a really cool guy. A bunch of people said that.
He was saying, these people are violent phalangists who need to be stopped. And then the next tweet he said...
Oh, yes, I was there.
To be honest, I would kill these people, I would shoot them. And I sort of posted, violent phalangists are bad, I'll shoot my political opponents. It's like,
yeah, right. That was pretty funny. And this guy, I was involved in this little shit fest. And this guy, he kept calling me and Mark, I believe, fascist pagans. Yeah. And I said, for a Christian reactionary, I make a very convincing fascist pagan, apparently.
And then it only later came out that he was then like Marxist, that he was actually like really pro-Marx. And I hit him with sort of this stuff, like, you do know that Marx hated religion and wanted to eradicate religion. Then he was like, yeah, people always bring that up. Yeah, because it completely refutes what you're saying. That's why people probably bring it up all the time.
And he'd follow some sort of attack where he was like, oh, but I just, focus on the material aspects of Marxism, neutral to the theological effects or something in that line of thinking.
Yeah.
And I was saying, like, for a Thomist, he seems to put awful lot of emphasis on efficient causes rather than final causes or first causes, which are more important than the efficient causes. So I think this guy's got it. And I had some other guy coming in there going, oh, this guy's a very Orthodox Catholic. I can affirm. And I said, you got your affirming really cut out for you, boy. Holy shit.
Look, these people aren't even really worth interacting with. The degenerates, the complete just detritus, bung it in the oven, gas mark six.
But this is the result of a church.
But to be fair, we started off kind of getting away from what Henry was talking about. Who are you talking about, Henry, with your back and forth?
Oh no, I'm sorry. It was a super liberal Catholic I was talking to, and but it's because I kept trying to make them realize, because I said he couldn't, I was mocking Dolan as like a Catholic leader, because I'm like, in the old days, if a leader got face to face with a heretic like that, they would have punched him in the face. And they're like, well, you can't say he's a bad bishop, blah blah, what makes a bad bishop? And I'm like, you wine and dine with a woman who supports infanticide, end of story. And we started going back and forth, and it was hilarious because she started pulling the, oh, well, I let God be the judge thing. And so I said, so let me give
her.
Yeah, and the best part was,
and then
was,
when you
I
completely
said,
demolished her argument, she's like, I gotta go to Mass.
Virtue signal.
Catholic virtue signaling. I'm
serious. What, you're saying that this was a woman?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, I would never engage with a theological debate on Twitter with some Catholic woman. She probably knows nothing. She's probably in like a feminist nunnery.
Well, but the best part was when I was mocking her, because she was going like, oh, well, I only God can be the judge. She said, I judge actions, not people. So I was mocking it. I said, yeah, just because Idi Amin dumped his political enemies to crocodiles doesn't mean he's a bad person. And she actually said, I'm going to let judge and the government decide that. And I'm like,
you're going to let the government decide it?
He was letting the government decide it. Because what the government says is going to be right, yeah.
Yeah.
Right, it sounds like the woman who sometimes trolls Michael Savage, saying, we should just have open borders. Like, there should be no borders.
Joe from Boca Raton.
It really makes you think.
We're not very well represented on Twitter sometimes.
I've listened to something by Michael Savage. It was like a Savage takedown, no pun intended, of an Iraqi war veteran that was kind of trying to use his status as a veteran to kind of like give credibility to what he was saying while selling liberalism. you know, it was, let me try to look it up. It was,
he can take down people pretty good. He's quite fun, really. Listening to
you guys see that Newt Gingrich with Megyn Kelly?
I haven't watched that yet. I've heard about it. I don't really like watching her, to be honest. She's a poisonous character.
She is, but it's funny. It's funny how Newt takes her down, though.
Yeah, you know, he's very smart. He's a smart guy.
Well, yeah.
I think I'm Michael Savage. I remember years ago listening to his radio show where some black guy called in, and he said something like, "No, Michael, I understand that since I don't remember what they were talking about exactly." He's like, "No, Michael, I understand this, but come on." And he's like, "What do you mean by come on? It's not an argument." And then he,
you know,
Michael Savage is a Jew.
I'm sorry.
Yes, I know, but he's entertaining.
He was at the left. He used to hang out with the sodomites, Ginsburg, and those people. He knows everything about these people. Same thing with Peter Hitchens. Peter Hitchens used to be a virulent leftist in his youth. And it's what makes them so effective in attacking a lot of these leftist positions, because they come from this background. They know these people personally.
Mm. Savage had a black guy call in who was obviously some kind of street bum. And he was just like, Savage was talking about the press. It was like, I think just right after Barack Obama got elected, this guy was like all hyped up saying, "Oh, he's going to win again. He's going to get eight years. And then Savage just like was sort of talking to him calmly, like saying, you know, don't you think, you know, aren't you worried about this guy's background, et cetera, et cetera. And this guy just goes absolutely mental on the phone and just goes, "He is the president, you bum. Now get off my phone."
That's the same guy who
called me.
That's the same guy who, the first thing he says is, he's like, "Hello, you're in there." The first thing the guy says is, "I think you're a racist cracker."
Oh, no. That's another guy. That's Frank from somewhere. Like, "I think you're a racist cracker."
Yeah.
And then he cites some like bogus number, like 5 million slaves died. And it's like,
I think you mean 6 million.
Six gorillion guys.
Yeah, Gregory has to be going, apparently. Thanks for coming, Gregory.
God bless.
You offended him, making fun of the 6 million. Good job.
Good.
We was Kangs.
No, Gregory's pretty red-pilled on the JQ.
We was Kangs, Josh. There was that funny thing on Twitter the other day where that black woman was like, "Most of us are royalty." And he just immediately walked into it. We was Kangs.
I knew the meme, but I never actually saw someone say that shit before. So I immediately just yelled out, "Kangs!" like out loud. Mm. My parents are looking at me like, "What is wrong with you?"
Yeah, I'll be honest. I've never actually seen it in real life. But the closest thing I got to it was on the when I was last in London, and I saw a poster on the wall on the London Underground for the for the Crown Jewels, to go and see the Crown Jewels. And there's just like a little black boy like looking at the Crown Jewels behind the glass, like he looks sort of like, "I want them." And my first thought was, "We was Kangs." You know?
I work with someone who believes the first shoguns of Japan were black guys. No joke. I read an article about it.
Even the Japanese aren't free of this bullshit.
No, not at all.
Yo, man, konnichiwa.
Liu Yi is probably thinking, that explains a lot about those.
Liu Yi and I decided that we was actually Kangs.
That wall, man.
Chiefs and shit.
We was Changs.
We was Changs.
We had a whole thread about that. Do you remember this, Liu Yi?
Yeah, I remember shitposting. I couldn't stop.
Yeah, we were talking about how because Aeneas and the Trojans are from Asia Minor, and they founded Rome. Rome is really an Asian empire.
Rome is really an Asian empire.
That's a bit more elaborate about I think Aeneas being
man. It was slowly through multiculturalism, was slowly replaced with white people.
That's right.
Well, there's basically a one-drop rule of human accomplishment. If a single non-white person contributed, that means no white people did anything. So
that's right.
Yeah, exactly.
Makes perfect
Yeah, oh, yeah. I remember what my one of my shitposts was. So it was so in Hittite, the name of Troy is Wilusa. So I concocted some Chinese name that sounded like Wilusa and said, well, this is the name of Troy actually comes from this in Chinese because the Trojans were from China. And then Aeneas went and founded indirectly the city of Rome. So all of you Romans are Chinese.
Oh, Lee, man.
I have to ask you, when you write, I don't know if any of you have tweeted with Lee before, but when he writes in words, he uses like the diphthongs for them. So like the connected O and E, for like if you say like Phoenix, you spell it out F O.
Yeah, I use ligatures.
You have to actually like hold down the O button for it to pop up, or do you have like a whole keyboard set up where you have that ready to go?
Oh, no, I just use my numpad. So I for the lowercase A E, for example, I hold down Alt and I punch 1, 4, 5, and then I let go and I release the Alt, and up comes the lowercase AE ligature.
Well, I want to bring back the umlaut for vowels that have that are separated by syllables, like cooperation. The second O has an umlaut over it. We should bring
that's
that
not back. An umlaut. Technically, yeah. That's a diuresis.
Okay.
Can I just say the umlaut never went anywhere? They're still using it in Germany. It's still there.
The umlaut.
No, but it's not there for vowel sound. It's only there to signify that the syllable is changing.
Right, right.
Like schön. Schön's got an umlaut over it.
Right. So the umlaut is something that moves the vowel to the front of the mouth. So something that's pronounced in the back, like O and U, becomes Ö and Ü. When you see the umlaut. Whereas in English, what we see is the diuresis, which differentiates the vowels of two syllables.
Hmm. I always like the Norwegian O that has a line through it. What sound is that? Does anyone know?
It's also Ø.
Ø. Ø.
It's usually a kind of closer kind of Ø than, say, in, well, so French has two sounds. There's Ø and there's Ø.
How many Ø's does the Norwegians have?
I think Norwegians have one. And it's closer to the
hang up for now.
Okay.
Right, bye.
See ya. Thanks for coming.
Yo.
Okay, so we're talking about umlauts, or
we're talking about
this is such an irrelevant topic.
You know,
we don't have a topic for this episode.
You know, on the subject of memes, I've actually taught my wife didn't do nothing, and now she actually uses it sometimes.
Oh dear.
Well,
yeah,
there are memes like that, but then the whole cycle of constitution is a meme, really. It's not just that all the bright people thought of this independently, it's that they're reading each other and this is a meme, and it happens to be a pretty good meme, so people will then say the same thing for hundreds and even thousands of years.
Mm.
Yeah.
But we didn't do nothing.
Speak for yourself, white man.
None of slaves built everything.
I'm a white man.
We don't need more Muslims. We need intelligent white people.
That's actually spot on.
C'est bon.
Yeah, sorry, guys. I haven't been saying a whole lot. I got dragged into another stupid Twitter argument. Honestly, this Twitter thing is the worst thing ever to happen to me.
Okay, who have you been arguing with? Who is it?
Why?
You want to know who it is this time?
Who is it?
It's less of an argument, because to an extent we're on the same side. It's more like a discussion between me, Tantum Malorum.
Okay.
And okay, spell that. Some spell other that? Guy. What is it?
It's Latin.
Tantum Malorum.
Oh, he follows me. I'm not making you up. I'm not pissing off a follower.
You're in it for the shekels.
You're on your own, bro.
Don't piss them off. Just put in enough tension for there to be some fun frisson.
Well, crying out loud, I go and look at my unfollows on Twitter.
I look at my unfollows.
Half of them are people who I don't remember ever following me, and the other half are people whose accounts have been suspended.
Right.
This is a consistent pattern. Like, usually, most of the people who unfollow me are just accounts getting suspended.
Yeah.
How do you see your unfollows?
It's on this thing called Tweeps Map that Louie showed me.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I don't know anything about it.
Yeah, I think you know what it is.
Yeah, Tweeps Map does that.
Is that a link?
Tweeps Map. Just Google it for crying out loud. Tweeps Map.
Yeah, Googling.
Tweep Maps.
Google it.
Yeah, I noticed most of the people who unfollow me are being banned. Like,
yeah.
I show up and it's like 5 banned accounts. And huh?
You do a lot of banning?
No, no, I don't ban. I mean, Twitter like kicks them off. Like.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Their accounts get suspended.
I wish I knew who they were.
It doesn't say.
I know. Like, I don't know. Like, is that guy I had a discussion with, like, you know, a day ago, is he still around? I mean, I just figured out like 2 weeks later at one point that, oh, that guy, he's gone now, when I try to look for him and just didn't show up.
Yeah,
I've had a few like that, people that I know who've just gone.
And then you go, okay, have they made another account? And if so, who are they?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, if they're worth your time, they'll probably refollow you if they make another account. So,
I mean, I wish I knew if
follow it's.
I have a follower in Uganda.
Well,
no, I've got followers all over the place. I've got a follower in Niger. Like, who's
quite popular
in Niger?
I have one in Ecuador, one in Siberia. Though it might have been some kind of proxy.
See, I know who the Ecuador is because I tweet with him very regularly.
Really?
Yeah. Diego Ortuño Rosales, I think his name is.
Ah, yes, that's ringing a bell. That would explain it a bit.
I know it's probably like Clemente Soto.
Yeah, I had one in Russian Mongolia, Siberia.
I've got a few Russian followers.
But not even Russian. I'm talking like way out there, like on the border with Mongolia. Siberia. Yeah. Don't know how that happened.
There's one in St. Helena. Who's that?
And you can use that to basically dox people, though, because I have like one follower or something from Australia, and it shows exactly that small, small town that he's from.
Wow. Mm.
And this is through Tweeps Map?
Yeah, because you can even sort it by city. So there's a certain follower where I can identify to where he lives within like 5 blocks, which is kind of creepy.
You've paid for the full version.
No, I haven't.
No. You,
really?
No, it gives you that automatically. You just, on the free version, if you click under where it says countries, it should have options for cities and states and provinces. That's under the free version.
I see that.
So my followers from Beijing.
I just Googled Tweeps.
I love how you say Beijing, by the way.
Vote Hillary.
One question I had, how real is the threat of doxing?
Depends how renowned you are. I think Ramsey Paul got doxed, to be honest, although he's never said as much.
Well, you kind of get doxed if you show your face like that.
Well, no, but I mean, like Millennial Woes hasn't been doxed, even though he shows his face.
Mm.
Like,
Paul put his real name out there, so I mean,
if you're afraid of being doxed, you can't do that. So it's gonna happen, right? I mean, as far as I know, Millennial Woes is like in need anyway, so it's not like he can be fired.
No, he's got a job, I think.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure he's in need. Store, isn't
he? No, he works at a charity bookstore because he did a video once where he picked up Kunta Kinte's book Roots, and
wrong.
He was like, "What's this doing in the non-fiction section?" Where should I go? And then he's looking all across the bookshelves, and he's like, "Fantasy, yeah, maybe." And then he goes, "Nah, not quite." And he goes over to the bin and just goes, "This is where this belongs, in the bin," and just throws it in there. It's a great video.
I think it was plagiarized, wasn't it? Roots.
It's mostly like an amalgamation, so it's not a,
yeah.
Right. It's like Obama's composite girlfriend. You remember that?
And the crazy thing about that thing is that they actually use it to teach in schools, as if it was like
in my World History 2 class. We definitely watched it.
Oh yeah, I mean they have an entire course here called African Canadian Studies, where it's basically you sit and watch Roots, and that's your reality, that's your history.
That sounds dreadful.
How many African Canadians exist?
Oh, by the way, they eliminated. There used to be a European history. They recently eliminated that entire course. So your only history specializations you can do are African Canadian studies and insert Native tribe studies. Take your pick.
Native tribes, that's not bad, but.
Well, it's mostly, you don't really learn that much about the Native tribe itself. You just learn about how bad white people are.
It should be called Indians.
Yeah, that's dumb.
Yeah, but it's more like feel bad about colonialist, like, privilege or some shit.
If I'm taking a class like that, I want to learn about the Mi'kmaq and the Cree and whoever else.
I mean, you don't learn, I thought it would be when I was first exposed to it, but I was pretty wrong there. It was just a whole thing about how Columbus was bad and how everyone's biased and how, yeah. I didn't learn one. I went through the whole thing. I didn't learn one thing about the actual Native tribe that supposedly the course is about.
Bias.
I am learning quite a bit, though, about, you know what, I'm not going to dox myself, so I'm not going to say, never mind. Keep going. Yeah, great.
Yeah.
So at my address at.
Well,
yeah. 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 Over here at 123 ABC Street.
Go ahead and mail feedback at this address.
You need to give exact latitude and longitude.
The one thing I don't like about the tweets map page is that there's more connections in Greenland than there are in basically the United States.
Great. How do you like you in there?
Tweeps map thing to work? It, like, can you just, do you have to sign up with it or log into it? Or
there's a free version, and they just, the only thing they require of you is like occasionally when you check it, they'll make you tweet out. They'll make your account plans. Tweet out something, but then you can just delete it. So
yeah, you're fine. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Look under plans, and then free plans. Start now.
56% of my followers are from America, so
I don't bother deleting it. I figure it's useful.
Yeah, it's not liking me.
Find.
There used to be a weird thing on the Twitter browser where if someone unfollowed you and you were on Twitter at the time, you get a little notification pop up saying, "So and so has followed you." Because I had that happen one time where. It said, so-and-so followed you. And I'm like, wait, I thought they already were. And I went to their page, and they had unfollowed me.
Hmm. Yeah, I got
and that. I think I know why, too, which is amusing.
Well, I think people do. I do that on accident. I'm looking through a list, I just clicking, and then I go, oh, no. And then and sometimes it even takes me weeks to realize that I've unfollowed somebody that I intended to keep following. So it's just a... I think sometimes
people. Yeah, but this person never followed me back, and they were kind of. I'm not gonna give them away, but they were kind of known for being super easily triggered. I guess you could say.
Yeah. Triggered by stuff.
The one question I have is it? Are they more likely to ban you on Twitter than say on Facebook?
I don't know because I don't use Facebook. I got off that a long time ago.
And more people and on Twitter, I think they tend to ban you when you get popular. If you're not that popular, I think they just don't bother most of the time.
Yeah, because I was never banned on Facebook. I mean, I was banned from Facebook groups, and I had one. Lady threatened to report me to Facebook because I had a heated argument with her over why I was banned from a certain Christian group for, you know, basically calling progressive liberal Christians heretics and that they're going to hell.
Yeah.
Well, you're not wrong.
I've only got 19 people who I follow who don't follow me back.
See other people.
I know there's one guy named Mark who doesn't follow me back. What's that all about?
I'm following you, for crying out loud.
Nah.
Am I not? Yeah, there's this weird guy named Joshua who keeps favoring my things. I think I'm going to follow him.
What a dick.
I am following you, Henry. What are you fucking lying about?
Yeah, I know you're following me. I paid you to. I mean,
crying out loud. And I don't, like, I wouldn't count the Russian embassy in the USA, which I follow. They're probably not going to follow me back, but okay. I like to keep up with their tweets because their tweets are getting better. Some tweets that have come out of these Russian embassies are pretty good at the moment.
Like, don't Trump or die.
No, like, so, say it. Oh, what was it? Don't Trump or there was glow. A tweet saying it was something to do with Syria, and they had some cartoon there, and it was very funny. It was, and everyone was outraged about it.
Oh, that little animation where it's like the Americans drop weapons and the Russians actually drop bombs.
Yeah.
Yes, I saw that.
That's like the it's like an embassy, and they're like shitposting. It's pretty good.
How hard is it to immigrate to Russia?
There's well,
or the East in general.
It depends what you mean. Like legally, do you mean, legally. Or just like economically? Like how hard it is to, you know, set up?
No, actually, just like say, hey, I want to live here, and I want to become a.
I don't think it's that difficult, to be honest. Obviously, it'll depend where you come from, but I don't think it's very difficult at all compared to the United States, where it's very difficult to immigrate legally into the United States.
If you want to be a farmer, they can give you a hectare for free, I think.
Well, really? In the United States, you don't have to ask for permission. You just come.
Yeah, I was about to say that. It's difficult to immigrate
well,
legally.
No. If you're Mexican, you can come in illegally. But remember that German family that tried to come in illegally? No, you're not allowed. You have to send you back to Germany.
That's because they were literally Hitler.
Yeah, literally Hitler.
Actually, practicing Christians.
Yeah, trying to get out of those Hitler-era mandatory public school laws, those Hitlerites.
Yeah, in Canada recently we had a whole thing about Ukrainians, and I think it was a South African that got kicked out, or they were trying to apply for refugee status. Like, oh, no, we don't want you. We don't want you. It was within a few years, both of them. And meanwhile, they're just importing these Syrians like they're going out of style.
Not surprised.
With it's special privilege like, given to gay Syrians as well, as Justin Trudeau said. We need to help the gay Syrians.
Who said this?
Yeah.
Justin Trudeau was like, we really need to make sure that we're getting a full quota of LGBT Syrians.
I call him Prime Minister Sparkle Pants.
He's Prime Minister fucking jailbait. It's bad guy.
I can't even stand hearing him speak or to look at him or the simpering smirk.
He's the epitome of liberalism, really.
I think he's the epitome of the new man.
Yeah,
classic new man. Trump. That's the funniest part about that.
Yeah.
Trump's a cartoon, but then they're like, Justin Trudeau is who I'm going for.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Justin Trudeau is authentic. He's the real thing. Keeping it real.
Yeah.
Keeping it real faggy is what he's keeping.
No socks.
I cannot do the tweeps map. Every time I hit authorize app, it tells me, whoa there, and then some nonsense.
You probably don't want to, you know, just let everyone do it. Just me.
Yeah, maybe.
They want to depress me.
You're not cool enough, man.
Exactly.
First or something.
First, you have to give your social security number.
And while you're at it, go ahead and type it in the chat.
Autodox. I must autodox myself.
You know, like, Justin Trudeau kind of represents, like, that minority of white heterosexual men who actually benefit from liberalism. Like, kind of, kind of like Matt Damon, in a way. He's kind of like that.
Hmm.
Matt Damon.
Or Ryan Matt Reynolds. Damon.
Ryan Reynolds. Yeah.
Are you...
What are we saying about them?
Yeah. Are you making fun of the way I talk?
No, it's no, these retarded actors.
No, oh, okay. It's from Team America.
Haven't
World
you ever
Police.
Seen Team America?
Matt Damon.
They made the Matt Damon doll, the puppet for it, but it came out looking so retarded that they actually like gave him Down syndrome. So everything he says is just Matt Damon.
Yeah. I've seen parts of that movie. I don't quite remember.
You should watch it. It's actually a
some of them are basically parody predicting reality. Like, I think I saw recently this comparison between that movie where they had what was it, the UN, with all the celebrities coming in. It's basically just composed of celebrities, and it was a joke then, but at this point that's what it's become. Where it's pretty much, we've seen these articles that all the celebrities have to come out and denounce Trump. You need to do your job as a celebrity. I mean, there was an article like unironically suggesting
like
this.
Swift.
I mean, yeah, they were completely straight faced, saying like your job as a celebrity is to become politically active, but make sure it's for Hillary.
It's our job to read the papers, and they repeat what we read as if they're their own opinion.
Yeah, that's what this. So, like, Helen Hunt says that or something.
I think it was Janine Garofalo.
Garofalo, that's it.
I think,
pretty much like that.
I take political opinions from him.
Who?
Russell Brand.
Oh yeah,
classic so Russell Brand. Such
that
inspiring.
That video where
he speaks a tear.
Have you seen him talk to Peter Hitchens?
That's what I was just about to bring up. When it's Peter Hitchens slapped him down, it was hilarious. I'd like to ask a question of the alleged comedian in the hat.
It's the same thing. It's Peter Hitchens has talked to him and talked to that guy from Friends. And both times he makes them look like complete morons. Well, of course, they probably are.
Which guy from Friends? Like David Schwimmer or Matt LeBlanc? Or
not Matt LeBlanc.
Matthew Perry.
Matthew Perry.
Oh, Matthew Perry, that was on drugs, wasn't it?
Yes.
I miss Peter Hitchens. He was my favorite atheist. He probably would have supported
that was Christopher
Trump
Hitchens.
Too.
That was Chris.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Hitchens was a neocon.
We're thinking of his brother.
Yeah, that's why I mean Christopher Hitchens was like the biggest neocon.
Yeah, he was a big neocon. He had a really good article in Vanity Fair about how women make shitty comedians. And it's on point. And of course, what's her face? The SNL girls.
Tina Fey.
Super offended. Tina Fey, they got super offended. Had a whole
article. Tina Fey. There's a talentless waste of space.
Tina Fey was created in a lab for virgin-signaling purposes.
Peter Hitchens is Christopher's brother.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yep. I know what you mean. I recommend his column. I think it's in the mail on Sunday, is where it is.
Yeah, he has some good works occasionally. I think he's he is a bit of an Eeyore for my taste, though. He's very sort of very depressed, and with good reason.
He is very much a pessimist.
He's kind of a race cuck too, isn't he?
He's cuckolded in a lot of.
Sorry, I'm kind of I was distracted for a second. Who are we talking about here?
Peter Hitchens.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah, he's okay. He's one of those guys where I started out to the left of him, then just screamed past him and kept going.
Yeah.
Another example of that would be like John C. Wright, Vox Day, all these guys.
Oh, yeah,
where,
yeah.
When I first meet them, I'm like, oh, they're such a crazy, like, Nazi. And then, like, a year later, wow, they're a bunch of, like, essentially liberals, bunch of moderates.
Mm-hmm. Peter's one of the lone voices.
All these kinds of except a bit of Peter Hitchens. I just had other people I knew, and it wasn't like stuff I watched or anything. We just talked.
I mean, just a disclaimer. Like, I am a bit of a fan of Peter Hitchens. I'm probably way more crazy and extreme than he is. but I think he puts out articles that are often worth reading.
I appreciate his earnestness. I think he's an honest guy at least.
He's also a useful stepping tool towards true reaction.
Yeah,
he's the gateway drug.
Yeah,
even if he's a Zionist.
Is he like a Islamo realist, like Geert Wilders?
He's not like Geert. He's not of that kind of counter jihad school, but he is very. I mean, he's probably closer to my opinions of Islam than Geert Wilders is, to be honest.
He's against mass immigration, but he's not like Geert Wilders in terms of rhetoric.
He doesn't like criticize Islam because it's not liberal enough.
It's more like we have.
That's
to
why I don't like. I don't like Wilders.
It's not sort of in the Milo Wilders school of we must defend, ass dickery from Islam.
Although I will say I do recommend people read Wilders's book Marked for Death, where he documents sort of his, what his political thing was, because it is quite well written, and it was probably one of the first explicitly political books that I actually read.
Was his documentary any good? I know he did a video documentary.
Oh, Fitna. I've never actually seen it. I sort of got out of that sphere before that hit, I think. I left that sphere sort of off around the time the Breivik attack happened, so I then didn't have much involvement with it.
Gotcha.
Is it common for people to start out in the counter jihad movement?
I've come across
move
a
over
few.
To, yeah. I've and move over to more right wing positions.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously, people come to this from various schools. I mean, a lot of people were libertarians. I've met some people who were communists, for crying out loud.
I was raised that way. I've always had that belief.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, of course, people exist as well. I'd say the counter jihad is obviously very easy. I think it's an easy stepping stone because it's a movement that kind of is at war with itself because it's trying to defend liberalism while liberals are attacking it as being Nazis and racists and fascists. And so eventually you do come to sort of ask yourself the question, why am I defending these people? Am I really sort of defending their right to be the way they are? And then you start sort of questioning the whole base, the basis upon which you've been criticizing Islam, which has been criticizing Islam from the left, essentially. And you start to say, maybe that's not the right critique to be actually watching against Islam.
It's kind of interesting, too, when you think about even some like friends of mine who I wouldn't necessarily say are red-pilled or reactionary. They would probably be somewhat like that, but on a softer scale. What I mean by that is they wouldn't necessarily say, oh, we have to attack Islam because it's not liberal enough based on like, oh, they hate gays or they hate women or something like that. It's more so, well, they're incompatible with democracy, almost like a sort of classical liberal, I guess you would say. Like,
well, it's a different flavor of the same thing.
Yeah. No, I'm saying, that's why I say it's a softer take on that, almost. But it definitely, that would probably get you closer to quote-unquote red-pilling, because then you have to say, well, why is it incompatible with democracy, and is democracy really worth saving when it's clear democracy enables this sort of cancer to grow?
Mm. And I think one of the good sort of be all end all refutations of the counter jihad was the do you remember when London elected Sadiq Khan as the mayor? And it actually turned out that even if all of the Muslims in London, the entire Muslim population of London, had stayed home and not voted, he still would have been elected, which kind of proves that it's not really religion that's the problem. There's a key kind of ethnic point there, which they were very consistent in completely ignoring.
Yeah, pretty much everyone who was an immigrant of some kind or who wasn't Britain voted for him.
Yeah, even like a Jamaican sort of Seventh Day Adventist was voting for Sadiq Khan because he wasn't the white guy.
Yeah,
and obviously the white guy in that election wasn't actually white. He was a Sky. I think his name was Goldstein. Yeah. No wonder people didn't vote for him.
Or he was what? He was a fellow white guy. My fellow white people.
I'm white, guys. Believe me.
Or maybe his last name was Heidelberg.
Oh no, it was Goldsmith. Goldsmith. That's it.
Well, okay. That's an actual English name.
No, but this guy was Jewish.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it comes back to the Jews.
Well, I mean, it's no wonder he didn't win. I mean, whites in London typically don't like the Jews anyway. But obviously not for JQ reasons, for more Palestinian brown people reasons.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right, speaking of which, how do you get from counter-jihad to JQ?
Yeah, well, that's kind of interesting, because obviously the counter-jihad is very pro-Israel, because, you know, Israel is Palestine. So
it seems kind of counterintuitive.
Yeah, but again, it's the same thing with regards to just leftism in general. Jews typically, and I think Babylonian Hebrew, who is a Jew, would agree with this in his judgment of Jews. Jews typically actually have higher views of Muslims than they do of Christians. Even though Muslims are more likely to kill them. They just have a higher view of them. I think it's due to a sort of large amount of more theological compatibility at a very deep level.
Yeah,
because there's a lot of similarities between Islam and Judaism. They both believe in a Unitarian God, and they're both iconoclastic.
Well, it's very, also God is very sort of distant in both religions. Yeah. He's very much this sort of untouchable entity, which is very anathema to the Christian idea that God became man and sort of saw things as we see them, felt them as we feel them. That's kind of antithetical to the entire Islamic and Judaic ethos. But
don't take me wrong here, Mark, but I get that sort of sense a bit even from Eastern Orthodoxy compared to Western Christianity, not necessarily with regards to revelation in Jesus, but just the way that God the Father, if that's the right way to put it, is viewed as sort of a more distant, more mysterious entity. I just get that that impression.
Absolutely, because God is very much separate from the Son, because we don't believe that the Holy Spirit proceedeth from the Son at all. He only proceedeth from the Father. And so that we definitely have a sort of more mystical conception of the Father. I'm not sure it's distant, because we experience the Father through the Holy Spirit in a kind of a very experiential way, as opposed to the very logical Western method. But Jesus is very much sort of personable, but no, the Father, like a good example would be in the West, in art, the West does depict the Father, like is it the Sistine Chapel that has the depiction of God the Father?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, I don't believe there are any Eastern Orthodox depictions of the Father, because he's not, you know, he hasn't manifested. It's like sort of depicting.
Although I would say that it's not that in the West. It's actually believed that God the Father is manifest as an old man with a beard in a human form. It's not what's implied. It's just that it's a sort of artistic license imagining, you know, a sort of an analogy. God is wise, therefore, you know, we associate wisdom with old men, therefore we draw him as such. Yeah, I think it's more of an artistic thing than a conceptual thing.
I love that idea.
Yeah, I think generally it's a bad idea to depict the Father, because the Father is, I would agree with Eastern Orthodoxy on this, that the Father is kind of transcendent, so you can't he doesn't really have a shape or form.
Well, Western Christianity certainly has that as well, philosophically, if not artistically. Even artistically, it's still pretty rare. I think we're making a bit of a mountain out of a molehill here. It's still not very common at all, and definitely.
I think the only point was that depictions of God the Father were not common in Eastern Orthodoxy. I don't think he was saying it was heretical.
I don't even think they weren't common. I can't think of any example of it at all.
I would say in the West it's not common, but it happens.
Oh yeah, and I think, but I think that's led to in popular culture him being depicted that way, and the same with the devil, by the way. I don't like the depiction of the devil as not even a fallen angel, but like this sort of demonic entity with, you know, the horns and the cloven hoof feet and the tail and the pitchfork, you know, because that's it's just so easy to satirize. And yeah. I don't like that.
I say yes and no.
Well, that's in some forms of iconography as well, like the ladder of divine ascent.
Yeah. And it's not even it's not even really, I think, biblically supported. No, I think the devil is, the devil would appear beautiful.
There's a reason he's drawn in that particular way. So I sort of agree. I say yes and no. It makes sense, but it doesn't. In the sense that it's trying to portray what the devil does to you is he reduces you to an instinctual animal who just feeds off of its material lusts. Mm-hmm. Which is why the devil is portrayed artistically as having the features of a beast, of an animal, such as horns and a tail.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But I would agree. I would agree that the devil approaches you not, you know, looking scary. He approaches you with a smiley face. He approaches you as your best buddy.
Yeah, I think he's described in the Bible. Angel of
Light. Well, there's a lot of variation there as well. I mean, the portrayal in, for instance, the Inferno is much different than how he's portrayed in Paradise Lost. Now, if we're talking about popular images of Satan, like Halloween, little kids, horns, something like that with a pitchfork, then I would agree. But I think in the case of how the devil's portrayed, often it comes to artistic license.
Mm. Yeah.
Although I will say this might have had some kind of negative effect, though, especially with sort of an intensely personalistic, I'm not going to say Protestant, but definitely post-Thomistic conceptions of God as even the sort of the kindergarten God is a thing, like a guy that sort of floats around somewhere past Jupiter as sort of a tangible thing within the universe is... Oh,
that's Mormonism.
Well, it's also some varieties
of... Do Mormons believe that, really?
Fedorism.
Yeah, yeah. Mormons do believe there is sort of an interstellar God.
Yeah,
but you see this in Fedoratastic arguments, like logically comparing God to, say, a teacup orbiting Jupiter, for example, or the idea that we went up to space and we didn't see him floating up there somewhere past the stratosphere, or all those like really Fedora-tier arguments you'll see in memes and like normie Facebook.
Yeah, I had a woman who tried to say, "Oh, we know hell doesn't exist because we know it's not there under the surface." And I'm like, "Well, no one really truly argued it was."
I had a woman actually tell me something similar, but she said, "We know that it's not there because we've dug to the center of the earth."
Which is also not true.
Oh my god. I just couldn't get over that.
Yes. Speaking of Eastern Orthodoxy, I have a question to ask. I've heard that there's. I'm asking this mainly to Mark, since.
Okay, I'll leave.
Yeah,
I'll try my best. But...
I mean, if you could input Henry, that'd be cool. But I've noticed that there's a lot of Western converts who have sort of an Orientalist take, where they have an over romanticized view of Orthodoxy, while like they really are pushing this exaggerated antithesis between Western and Eastern Christianity.
Yep.
Like for example, they distinguish between ancestral and original sin when, based on what I read, I even have the source I can link to you, the Greek fathers really use both terms, and the Augustinian view of sin, which these Orientalists or revisionists, whatever you want to call them, they mainly contribute most of Western Christian theology on original sin and depravity to Saint Augustine.
Mm.
Well, I think what you have in a lot of cases, especially in the West with Eastern Orthodox converts, some of whom I interacted with during my time in Eastern Orthodoxy, is you have a kind of almost like they're trying to imitate Catholic answers, and they're trying to come up with all these really cool arguments. And so a lot of times they'll try to almost they almost become like seeker sensitive pastors in a way, in the sense that they want to try to make they're trying to make Eastern Christianity unnecessarily unique. Now, I'm not saying Eastern Christianity is not in any way unique, but they're trying to make it unnecessarily unique in the sense that they might take something that is, like we were saying earlier, you know, they in essence take a molehill and they turn it into a mountain when, you know, no one really cares, or, you know, you might set two serious Western Eastern scholars in a room and they're going to be like, well, okay, we can talk about this for 10 minutes, but after that we'll get bored. So, I mean, things like, you know, ancestral and original sin. I mean, I've read the Eastern Orthodox arguments. I think in some respects, Eastern and Western people are kind of arguing over each other. Because as you said, the terminology and the understanding was kind of understood both ways. And I think it's more so in the judicial aspect that the disagreement arises.
I'm going to sort of disagree, because I've recently been witness to and even taken part in arguments between Romanists and Eastern Orthodox. And I think at the level of the conception of God, which is sort of what I mentioned earlier about like 10 minutes ago, I think Mark said something about that. It is actually quite different, as I've been discovering, just the way that God, or at least the Holy Spirit, relates to God and to the Son, to the Father and to the Son.
Well, that's why I said unnecessarily unique. I wasn't necessarily saying there aren't differences, because there are differences, like in question of the atonement, or you know, the issue when Roman Catholics try to say that aerial toll houses are exactly like purgatory, and I just roll my eyes. You're absolutely right. There are differences between
the two. What is like purgatory?
Aerial toll houses.
What the hell is that?
Basically, it's a Eastern Orthodox belief. It's considered, and Mark can correct me, maybe he's heard different, but it's not considered like dogmatic tradition. It's more like local or small t tradition. But basically, after you die and you're ascending to heaven, you encounter these quote-unquote toll houses where demons will confront you about different kinds of sin, and you in essence have to pass through each one towards heaven. Now the thing is, I've studied the history behind this belief, and it changes. I mean, people had different views, people had different ideas of how you get past these toll houses. Like, there was a crazy mystic that had an idea that you had to have a coin from a saint, and a saint would give you a coin, and you gave that to the demon.
I would point out this isn't held by all Orthodox.
Correct, only by some.
Thanks for the link, Sam. I'm looking at it now.
It's
kind of like a final temptation. There's sort of this gap between your death and your assumption into heaven, where you can still fall away, essentially.
Right.
Yeah.
You can still go to hell, is what you're saying.
Yeah, you can still be tempted. Well, if the demons it's more about accusal. The demons will accuse you, and if you, you know, if you can overcome that, this is very much tied into theory of atonement as well. Then, you know, you're good. It's sort of like this final area of test. I'm not entirely sure about its origin. I'm not a historical theologian, so I couldn't tell you about the where it first originated. But it is quite early, I believe.
Do you know how many?
It's also like, I think a lot of the Orientalist converts from the West are trying to import postmodernism into Eastern Orthodoxy, because you know, it's true that Eastern Orthodoxy is more mystical than Western Christianity.
Yeah,
but mysticism doesn't necessarily mean postmodernism.
Oh no, not in any sense of the word. I don't know how would somebody interpret mysticism as postmodernism?
Well, I think
on the level of subjective experience. Oh, sorry, I was interrupting you there. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say too, I think what you might be also referring to is a lot of Eastern Orthodoxy in the West has sort of a similar problem to Roman Catholicism in America, where you have three different camps. You have the Orthodox, little Orthodox, and they see things very historical. They see things as, for lack of a better phrase, by the book. And then you've got the liberal, you know, just sort of basically cradle Orthodox that don't really care. They go to church and whatever. And then you've got the kind of in-between scholars where they don't like certain doctrines or they don't want to defend certain doctrines, but then at the same time, they want to seem Orthodox, so they'll try to reinterpret things, sort of like post-moderns do.
You think like Rod Dreher?
I don't know who that is, actually.
Yeah.
So Rod Dreher is the blogger for the American Conservative, the Benedict Option stuff.
I believe he's Orthodox.
He is Orthodox.
Yeah, yeah.
He is Orthodox. He used to be Catholic.
The worst one is
kind of sort of mushy, moderate, you know, a bit of a weasel, really. He blocked me from his comment section.
Well, he doesn't respond to a lot of people, and no one from his church actually knows him.
Yeah.
He just, I tried to dialogue with him.
Stuff, but he is super whiny, and it's difficult to sit through some of his articles sometimes.
Yeah, the only thing about him is he gets close and then he just falls back. Like, he gets close to the truth and then he'll just go, oh, no, but more liberal values.
He doesn't take it back to the logical conclusion. Yeah.
Well, the one person I was thinking of is Frank Schaeffer.
That's a good example.
I absolutely hate that guy. I mean, his dad was actually a good guy, Francis Schaeffer. I mean, I don't know why like he turned out the way he was.
I mean, for all his parents' faults, which, you know, I mean, of course everyone's a sinner, he just seems really unfilial in his tone.
I'd say you just got to be very wary of... I mean, it depends who you're talking to. There are Western converts to Orthodoxy who are liberals.
Yeah.
I'm not sure why they convert.
Well, like Frank said,
I think the Antiochian church has been particularly guilty of this. They have been very active in evangelizing America for, I'm not sure why, but for some reason, and they have, as a result, laxed their teachings to accommodate liberals on many occasions. Like, you're most likely to encounter a liberal priest in America in Orthodoxy in an Antiochian church.
Right.
It's not amazingly likely you'll find one in a Russian church. Even the Greek churches, which are known to be more liberal, you're not going to have people, like, going sort of over SJW on you. That does sometimes happen in these Antiochian churches. I believe it was actually an Antiochian church that, quote-unquote, excommunicated Max Heimbach, even though they had no authority to do that. But
I actually talked to a guy who's a member of the Antiochian Orthodox Church, and I was trying to get him on, but he hasn't made it on yet. So
the Antiochian Orthodox Church, it doesn't reflect the church in Antioch. I'll just say that. It's
Well, that really isn't an Antioch anymore, is there?
Or Isn't the Antiochian Church, isn't that part of, like, the Oriental Communion along with the Armenian and Ethiopian Church?
The Patriarchate of Antioch is Eastern Orthodox. There's a Syriac Church of the East, which is in the same area. That's part of the Oriental with the Copts and Armenians. But that's separate, yeah.
Aren't the Ethiopians something like Miaphysites or something? I had the impression there was a major theological difference there with regards to the conception of.
I'd probably group them with the Orientals. So that most of the Orientals were accused of Miaphysitism. That's why they went into schism after the Third Ecumenical Council.
So they're not in communion with Constantinople.
They're not in communion. We cannot share chalices with them.
On the other side, there's the Assyrian Church of the East, which is accused of Nestorianism.
That's right. Yeah, the Syriac Church of the East is accused of Nestorianism. Right. I forgot that.
They were also possibly the first ones to get to China.
Yes, which is why Chinese Christianity has historically been Nestorian.
Well, then that church kind of died anyway. But some people actually believe that St. Thomas was the first one to get to China.
No, St. Thomas is India.
But, well, it's known that St. Thomas got to India, but some people believe that he also went to China.
Well, wasn't he skewered? Did they skewer people in China?
He was supposedly skewered in India, I think.
Well, he died in India.
I get skewers from the Chinese place down the street.
Oh, yeah.
Skewers. Skewers, you say?
Skewers.
The one question, do Eastern Orthodox consider Oriental Orthodox baptisms valid?
Oh, that's a tough question. I don't know. My assumption would be, my guess would be that it's a lot like Catholic baptisms in that it's very vague. There are some priests that will not count it, and there are others that will. There was actually a cool YouTube video of this Orthodox priest giving a talk, and he talked about how he'd had some guy come to him and who was had been a Catholic and then had been baptized in, well, had joined the Orthodox Church. And the first church he was at, the priest said, "You've already been baptized, you know, the baptism's accepted, you just have to be chrismated and everything, and then you're good to go." He went to another church, and the priest said, "No, you've not been baptized, you're not Orthodox," so he gave him a baptism. And then he went to a third church, and the guy said, "How were you baptized?" And he said, "Well, you know, they put my head in the water," and he said, "You weren't fully submerged." And he goes, "No, I wasn't fully submerged in the water." Then he goes, "You haven't had a proper baptism, then I need to give you." So he went through these three entrances, and the priest just stops for a minute and just goes, "Who were these priests?" It's like it's not very well sort of controlled or documented. So
as far as I know, in Rome at least, a baptism can be performed by anybody. They're pretty sure they consider it a sacrament that anybody can do.
Pretty loose. I've even been told you can use Coca-Cola. I mean, It gets pretty wild.
Coca-Cola. Okay, that's getting a little.
I mean, that's really going out there. I have heard
people say that. That is not a joke.
Orthodox and Catholics have generally had an agreement for a little while now that, in extreme circumstances, it is valid for somebody to receive, you know, sacraments or / mysteries from another priest. If there's an emergency situation and you know you don't have another option, you can do that. It's valid. Because I think, like, people on their deathbed who want to receive some kind of last rite or something like that, or anointing, if there's not a priest of the faith around, they can default to another one and it will still be valid.
I know that in terms of the Catholic view of Orthodoxy, we do consider Orthodoxy an authentic Christian church, and her sacraments are valid, just not in full communion with Rome.
No, that's actually one of my little pet worries is, in fact, being, you know, on my deathbed. For various reasons, I participate in activities that can sometimes be dangerous. And the idea of, like, lying there and going, "Oh, I have it written down, you know, I'm an Anglican," and then having some priestess show up, that would be really scary. I almost have, like, an impression. Maybe it would be safer for me to just say, bring me a Catholic priest. Though I don't know if they'd have me.
They'd come to you.
Because at least then, because obviously within Anglicanism, at least as far as I know, Roman orders and Eastern orders are considered valid. So from my point of view, that's not really a problem. Like, at least I'd be guaranteed. Well, okay, you laugh all you want there. Okay, at least I'd be guaranteed someone that's a legitimate priest. Whereas if I just said Anglican without specifying, I could end up with
that acceptance doesn't flow both ways. So
yes, I know. It's only a one-way street.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm actually going to head out here. So I'm going to say good night to y'all.
Have a great night.
Bon see you. We all re.
All right. See you later.
I'm probably going to need to go pretty soon.
Yeah, I was going to say we should probably wrap up within the next 15 minutes or so.
Yeah.
Well, I was just going to introduce a new topic.
Night, night, guys.
Well, okay, that's fine. You can have a good night. If you have a topic, feel free to introduce it.
Oh, I was just baptism. We were just talking about baptism. Uh-huh. No, I was baptized full immersion in a completely heretical sect, and yet I must say that I was baptized in a
the movement. The Moomins?
No.
Christadelphians.
I was raised a Christadelphian, yes. Oh, somebody remembered.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I even want to know what that is.
I remembered. I was just muted.
Yeah, it's just
was it a Baptist?
It was a 19th century heretical sect. Actually, kind of proto-Zionist.
Oh, dear.
Super. We defaulted to the Old Testament over the New. Anyway, but we did do, you know, proper dunking for baptism. But I was in a jacuzzi in California, so that's kind of tacky as can be.
Dude, I got baptized in a totally horrible situation. I was baptized by a woman bishop.
Oh, crying out loud.
But
cleanse yourself.
Yeah.
And I've got
like some meditation on the peaks to get rid of that.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
Conditional baptism.
But I gotta say that the christening thing, I've watched a lot of kids be baptized and my own kids and at the font with some water kind of splashed on the head. I find it kind of flimsy.
It is.
Aesthetically, spiritual aesthetics, I find it just really flimsy. And I've actually heard of triple dipping infant baptisms in the Anglican Church in, you know, in the name of the Father, dip, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, dip.
I mean, I think if John the Baptist had just like splashed Jesus with some water, I think he would have felt kind of a little gypped.
Do you guys do full immersion in the...
Yes.
Are you fully immersed?
Yep.
Because I really honestly, I'm not really certain. Although, I mean, I was baptized. I've been some kind of Christian all my life. I was baptized in this heretical sect. I was, by chance, baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Not the Holy Ghost. They don't say ghost, but a lot of there is another formula used often in the Christadelphian baptisms. But I mean, it's a totally heretical setting. That's the only baptism I've had. I haven't had a new one. The Anglicans accepted it. But if I'm going to be re-baptized, the idea of somebody pouring some water on my head makes that better than a California jacuzzi baptism. I have a hard time with that. Like, I don't. But if I could have a proper full immersion baptism in a decent setting, anyway, it's something I'm working towards. I'm not sure.
I prefer churches to be like situated near rivers or oceans to actually sort of get the full effect rather than just sort of putting you in a tub.
In the a lot of Christadelphian, if they actually build their own hall, they build a.
Although, you know, I will say.
Bathtub up front.
In Russia, in certain colder regions where they've, you know, built churches out on the ice, they'll actually cut, and you can actually see sort of pictures of that, they'll cut cross shaped. Large pools out of the ice, and that's where you'll be dunked fully under and then brought out this freezing cold water. I just thought that was quite amazing. Loads of people still do that. I think it's to mark Pascha. They'll go and have re-baptism, and you see these lines of Russians in their swimwear just being dunked into these sort of cross-shaped pools in the ice. It's amazing that people still go and do it.
That's amazing. That's the polar bear swim, we call it here, secularly. But they, if they have a, I lost my thought.
Well, I got to head out now, so I'll see you later. Hopefully I'll catch the next hangout, maybe a bit less late this time.
There's still two Anglicans left. Good. Good.
somebody's asking in the chat about Callistos Ware. Thanks for coming, man.
Have a good one, but good to see you. Or good to talk.
He's a little too accommodating for my liking, but he's smart and he's a joy to listen to, I think. But still, I mean, he's definitely of the West in his kind of thinking, in many ways, outside of religious matters, you know, as it pertains to political questions, you know, theopolitical questions. And as such, I'd certainly default more to, I usually read like what Russian priests are saying on issues of church and state rather than whatever Callistos Ware is saying. But he's an intelligent guy. I recommend people pick up, I think his book's just called Orthodoxy. But it was lauded by Orthodox around the world for being a very good introductory text.
Okay. Didn't you in the past say that he was not in any way a traditionalist?
No.
Something to that effect, I think you said.
I say he's not, I wouldn't call him a liberal, but he's of the Patriarch Bartholomew school rather than the Patriarch Kirill school, which is less, you know, it's less conservative, it's more accommodating. I think he was asked once about female bishops, and he said his response is no, but he's not kind of closed on the question, which I think it should be an automatic no. It's closed. It's very clear that that is unacceptable. So, yeah. Then again, that interview was in the 90s. I mean,
since we're on Orthodoxy, I see a lot of quotes on Twitter from a Father Seraphim Rose.
Oh, yeah. People always love to quote the Rose.
Well, he's got a lot of great quotes. So what's the deal with him?
He's just very sort of well-known writer of Orthodoxy. He wrote, what's the book he wrote? He wrote a very well-read book. Let me bring up the title. I don't actually own it. People keep telling me to get it. Let me see what it was called. He wrote... Oh, so he was around during the Samizdat era. So during the communist era. So he's not like an old figure. What did he write? There's a book that he wrote that everybody was always recommending. Oh, Bibliography. Here it is. I think it might be Letters from Father Seraphim. That may be the one people keep recommending me.
Because I see the quotes all the time, and they're fantastic quotes.
Yeah, yeah. He was, I don't know if you call him a reactionary, but he was... He was definitely of the old tradition. He wasn't a modernizer in any way. So I'd group him in with people like St. John of Kronstadt. He's in that kind of vein of thought. He's very popular even outside Orthodoxy. People do quite. I've spoke with loads of Catholics who've read his books. I should pick them up, but I've always got something on the go. I'm always like reading something. I'm now on.
Well, I had wanted to ask you about it because you're really the only Greek Orthodox person I ever got a chance to talk to on these hangouts.
I'm not actually Greek Orthodox. I just attend a Greek Orthodox church because there's no Russian one nearby. So
I meant Orthodoxy in general. I didn't mean
Greek Orthodox. No, I don't have an ounce of Greek in me, so it's I'm kind of an innocent abroad in that church.
I don't have any Roman in me.
Well, that's kind of different, isn't it?
I think my Italian side's from Milan, actually.
Also, if you had any Roman in you, then it would actually be sort of Chinese. So
that's right, because we was Changs.
Yeah, we was Changs.
Is the Patriarch of Constantinople a CIA plant? I think that was something somebody else was asking.
I maybe wouldn't go that far, but he's got people who are CIA plants around him. So best to wait out his tenure and make sure that he doesn't do anything too stupid. We're very cautious. You know, it's not like Catholicism where you can let somebody like Pope Frank in and just start saying whatever he wants.
Frank is just the worst.
If you get someone like that, you've got to sort of.
I'll take a Borgia over Frank at this point.
You'd take like an anti-pope in France. So.
Yeah, you know, let's return to Avignon. Let's just do it. F it.
Oh, man. I was so surprised to read that. You know, this is the Society of St. Pius?
Yes, I know about it.
With Lefebvre. I didn't know this before. Did you know that one of their members had tried to assassinate Pope John Paul II in Portugal?
I had heard about it, but I don't know too much about the details.
I had no idea this is a good. I was just reading about it. It was crazy. He tried to like stab him with a flag or something.
We have plenty of people in holy orders who are very good at assassinations. I believe Henry III was killed by a monk. Henry III of France.
Yeah, well, you know, they do what they have to. I mean, it was a couple of priests who tried to assassinate Rasputin in Russia. They weren't successful, but
think there was a Jesuit priest that assassinated Prince William of Holland, who was a Calvinist.
Are you talking about William the Silent?
Yeah.
No, he wasn't a priest. Balthazar Gerard was just a regular everyday guy. In terms of like, he wasn't a priest.
Is he like a religious sort of thinker, though? Is he like sort of Peter the Hermit?
No, there was a price on, because technically everyone in the Netherlands or Belgium did owe allegiance to Philip II, because we were just fresh in the middle of the Dutch Revolt. So you had a lot of people who were still loyal to the King of Spain, and William the Silent had a, I guess you could call it like a bounty on his head, so to speak. Anyways, Gerard's family was taken care of for the rest of their lives, and there are streets in Belgium named after him. But I did look it up. Henry the Third was killed by Jacques Clément, and he was he was disguised as a priest. And then Henry IV was assassinated by somebody as well. I think he was another priest as well.
Yep. Is it a kind of LARPy to disguise yourself as a priest while you assassinate someone?
It's super LARPy.
Yeah. I think
it's acting. It's not even LARPing.
I think in one of the Hitman games you could do that.
I think the entire idea of Hitman is you can do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what, I don't know. I love those kind of games. The whole Assassins thing. Dishonored 2 is coming out, and I'm
ecstatic. Yeah, I thought that game was underrated, to be honest.
What would be really LARPy?
Yeah, Dishonored is underrated. I can't praise it enough.
Yeah. Well, I don't know, it didn't blow me away, but it was. I think it got kind of shat on a little bit and ignored. And
it got Game of the Year awards. I mean, it got pretty.
Oh, good. Really? Yeah, yeah. I just didn't think it was bad. It had some really good elements. It had a nice art style.
Nobody really talked about it.
I think it escalated a little too quickly. It ended a little too soon.
It was a short story. It was pretty quickly done, but I've played it multiple times, so I got my money's worth out of it.
I wish I played more. This sounds so degenerate. I wish I played more Vidia, but I don't have like a modern gaming console anymore. So
yeah, I have one. It took me $1,600 to build it, and I learned to build it by myself.
You built a game console.
Are you sure it's not a PC?
It's a PC. That's what I said. Computer.
Oh yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, because when I think of gaming console, I think of Xbox or PlayStation.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm not that plebby. Anyways.
PC Master Race. Look at this guy over here.
But I don't play that often because honestly, you know, there are better things to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, there are really.
I've been playing Angry Birds 2 a lot.
I'm gonna say
play that public.
I only really play Vidia anymore if for like nostalgia factor. I don't follow new games coming out and say, "Oh, I'd really love to get that and play that." Because
I play Clash of Clans.
Isn't it like an online game?
No,
it's a mobile game.
Oh yeah,
it's fun.
I only play some a Tetris game.
You know,
but about six times.
If you really want to spend, if you really want to save money on video games, get them like. After a year after they come out, they get very cheap, or 2 years.
Oh, wait, 5 years, then they're cheap as chips.
That's really the appeal of PC gaming as well, is the games are super cheap.
Yeah. That's true.
I've got a PlayStation 2 sitting right here next to me, plugged into the TV, and I can't play it at the moment because I haven't got a controller. But for Christmas, I'm going to have people get me a controller and get me a shit ton of like £1 games that at the time when they came out were, you know, 30-40 quid, but now I get to enjoy them all over again for cheap price.
You have an emulator, you can play old Nintendo games. for free.
Yeah, the emulators are getting better. I'm very impressed with what they've been able to do.
They have a little Nintendo you can buy that has like 30 of the classic NES.
Yeah, I saw that. A lot of those are out of stock, though. It's difficult to find them. They sold out really quickly. What's being linked here with Nick B. Steves? Nick said?
Yeah, there? William linked something in the text chat here.
I just visited Twitter briefly and.
It's a Quora question, I see.
He has all so many Quora questions. How does that work? Does he just choose random questions that are there?
Yeah.
So I only ask FM.
Is it the same as Ask FM?
He has Ask FM as well.
It's like.
No, Quora and Ask FM are two different things.
No, I realize they're different, but I mean, are they the same idea where people ask you questions or are you just answering questions?
It seems to be.
So it's different because people just ask questions into the ether, although they may request, I think.
And then you answer them by, but are they organized by category or something? Or?
Yeah. So as a user, you have, you indicate your interests. So that's going to show stuff in your feed that is related to your interests. So my Quora account has, I think I've put down linguistics and stuff like that. And Quora tends to favor the kinds of answers that come from people who have degrees in the subject or something like that. So if you have a PhD in the field, your answer is going to automatically have, it's going to be ranked higher.
So you've entered this information and they've somehow confirmed that it's
right. Except, you know, sometimes the questions are really actually. I've worked for Quora before as an independent editor, so I've seen literally hundreds of Quora questions that look like this. My score on the JEE mains is 174. My ranking is 14,572. Will I get into IIT Madras?
Full information there.
Yeah, that I've seen literally hundreds of this kind of question. Also, another kind of Quora question that's very common among Indian men is, who is the prettiest girl at such and such a school in India? I just go, oh, so these are the kinds of questions that Americans don't ask, but apparently it's a thing in India.
Well, I'm surprised they're not asking, like, where is the nearest designated shitting street?
Oh, we're back at it.
There we go. Oh,
yeah. Well, on that note, I've got to go. This is ridiculous that I'm up this late. I've got to get up in the morning.
Thanks for coming, Mark.
Yeah, later, guys. See you next time.
Have a good night.
Bye.
You know, I've just been thinking about something lately. I know I said I wanted to wrap up soon, but something that I've been thinking about lately is about this whole alt-right, dissident, reactionary, whatever you want to call it, sphere that we all kind of know each other through. I mean, I've been thinking recently, like, this mostly... Most of this is all done online. Like, so I'm wondering, do we all like really understand each other as well as we think we do? Or are we all in some ways talking past each other? Cause like, I'm just been thinking about how some of us come from different countries. We live in different parts of the US or different parts of whatever country we're in. And there's a lot of differences between us and I wonder like if we're as much on the same page as we think we are, just because people have different ideas about what's normal and what's not. Because, I don't know, sometimes when I listen to discussions people are having, or that doesn't ring true to me at all. Like, so I don't know why they think that or something.
Yeah, I feel that way. I mean, a lot of things that the alt-right has, I'm not on board with. Like, for instance, the idea of an ethno-state is one that I'm not completely sold on. Not that I am necessarily against it, but it's one that I don't really consider to be a pressing matter. I mean, I think the spiritual aspect is much more important, and I think a lot of people who really push on the ethno-state concept really leave that out too frequently. For instance, like, I don't know, what's a famous account like Walt Bismarck. I don't think I have anything in common with Walt.
Yeah,
you know,
I mean, the way I discovered this whole alt-right thing was by watching his videos, which I thought was very funny, but
and they're hilarious, and I enjoy them.
Yeah,
I really do.
Yeah,
but I don't really have any commonality.
No, it's like, I mean, I definitely don't have any commonality with the racialists, like the hardcore materialist reductionist racialists out there.
And that's in the Greece too. Like I wouldn't, because like for instance, not all the ethnocentric Twitter accounts are like, for instance, the fascist side or anything like that. I mean, there's a broad spectrum. And a lot of them I don't get. A lot of them I do understand. Like for instance, Ian, I follow a lot of your tweets, and I pretty much agree with you on a lot of things. There's very little disagreements that I have. But like for instance, a lot of the more like the really fascist aspects of it, I don't follow.
I don't consider myself fascist so much as a lot of other people are. Like, I mean, well, like, for what are you talking about specifically? Like, do you have an example of something I tweeted that you didn't agree with?
No, most of the time I see you tweeting is usually in response to somebody else.
Yeah.
I agree with what you were saying most of the time. In fact, I can't really think of anything I disagreed with you on. But I wouldn't consider myself, and I don't consider you fascist either. That wasn't what I was trying to get at.
I mean, but if you mean like I can... I sometimes, I mean, I'm not out there trying to be an edgelord necessarily. I'm trying to, like, just sort of push back against all that stuff.
I think you're very respectful too. I mean, you're conversing with these people. Like, there's that one old Hispanic lady you're always talking to, and she's always talking back to you.
Lydia Grace Suarez, yeah.
Yes, I enjoy reading those conversations.
Sometimes I don't even reply to her because I think what she's saying is just dumb. So I'm just like, this isn't even worth responding to. But yeah, sometimes she says something I can respond to. I'll say what I can, but
right. But you'll talk about like, you know, white interests and things like that, and I agree with those things. I do, but when it gets to like for instance, I'm not in full agreement with people like Taylor or Spencer.
Yeah,
I find that just a bit too out there for me.
Well,
yeah, those are the hardest. Those are like the types I'm really talking about. How like they tend to be more of a atheistic, reductionist, materialist, geneticist.
Yeah,
they're spreading about material stuff, which, you know, that it's not a thing, but it's not the thing that they think it is.
Yeah.
Well, I just
think their sites are improperly placed.
So yeah. Well, that's kind of how I think of myself, too. I mean, like, as far as the whole thing about being a, you know, white nationalist or whatever, I mean, I don't necessarily call myself a white nationalist. Maybe a couple years ago, I might have sort of said that about myself. But I mean, nowadays, I think the whole idea of having an ethno state or like having a homeland, like I think that's a good thing. I think that's conducive to, you know, peace and prosperity or whatever. But I mean, like it's, and, you know, human flourishing, but like I don't think that's the end point. Where I differ is that some of those people kind of see that as like an end goal, whereas I see that as like a start, but it's not the end. Because I mean people have ethno states that fail because, you know, they absorb liberalism or whatever. So I mean, like
Iceland, you know, is, you know, very white, but you know,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, Sweden used to be an ethno-state, and look at them now. I mean, so,
yeah,
like, they probably won't even exist in 100 years. I mean, it's really that bad. Mm-hmm. They're just like that suicidal. But I guess, yeah, I mean, I guess when I talk about white interests or whatever, like, I in a way, I kind of don't like that terminology. I think it seems kind of crude in a way, but, like, it's kind of shorthand for the idea I'm getting at. Like, I mean, and just mentioning Jared Taylor again, he said that like people will say to him like, well, you know, why do you talk about white interests instead of like particular ethnic interests or whatever, like German or Irish or whatever. Like he says, well, because if someone basically, like, even if whites don't think of themselves as white belonging to a group, they still.
Hello?
You there? I think we lost you, Ian.
Lost our host?
Dun, dun, dun.
Uh-oh. The JQ has come up again.
Shut him down!
Shut him down!
Shut it down.
I think, too, I don't like the term alt-right because I feel like many on the alt-right aren't even of the right. They're just leftists who are outside the quote-unquote Overton window.
And, yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, but I don't
prefer, really like the myself, new reactionary.
Not alt-right. I mean, it's easy enough, I think, to describe what we individually, what our opinions are, but what are we, yeah, socially, what is this thing we're part of?
Yeah, I prefer the title neo-reactionary to alt-right. I feel like I agree with more of their core ideas.
I've been using the
DRX hashtag recently because I think that's really in line mostly with what I'm thinking, the counter-revolution concept.
Right, so you are CRX along with Harach and some of those people. Nick Steves is NRX. Yeah, I don't think I'm either of those, so.
And I'm not necessarily hostile to think. For instance, I think NRX is interesting, and I think it's got a lot of interesting things to say, but I do think that that's a little too top-heavy oriented for me. You know what I mean? I feel very strongly that any meaningful action will have to happen from the bottom up.
Yeah. It's sort of like the way I got into these circles is indirectly through, the Christian Reconstructionist movement, how, like, with R.J. Rushdoony, how he's anti-democracy, and some of the NRX guys have the same critiques.
Right. We've mentioned the Benedict option several times. The Benedict option, although I don't think it's perfect, that style, that mode of thinking is much more in line with how I envision.
It's vague.
Going forward. It is vague. I think it's purposely vague. I don't think it's meant to be a prescription for how to handle the future. I think it's meant to be a very vague statement saying if you're going to hold to things like subsidiarity, you have to practice subsidiarity. That means practicing it in your own life, not just in a wide governmental aspect. It requires human action. Yeah.
There's more to politics
and I'm not against
what the magistrate does.
Exactly.
Yeah,
I'm not against things like NRX in principle.
So you guys didn't miss me while I was gone?
Well, we you cut off, Ian, because you were talking and then you just dropped.
Yeah, my connection got screwed up for some reason, but
you sound very different now.
You sound different.
I plugged into a different computer. Yeah.
Oh, you sound like a different person.
You sound different.
Do I?
Yeah.
Well, maybe I'm sitting differently now too, so maybe that's something to do with it. I don't know.
No, you sound deeper. You sound more manly.
Well, thank you very much. I'm a true Aryan man. Yeah.
Dude, I think Aryan here.
I think too.
Aren't the four levels of government, self-government, family, church, and the state is the final one.
The three estates. Society.
Well, four estates.
I don't know if you're familiar with Carlism, but Carlism had four kind of like principles. I don't know if I'm going to remember it correctly, but the principles were like king,
country,
God, and
fueros,
which is kind of like, I guess you could call it like a local kind of government.
Yeah, I like the fueros thing, even though I'm not a Carlist. I mean...
No, I'm not either, but I think it's a good slogan, so to speak.
Although, in terms of monarchical lines in Spain, yeah, Carlism all the way. I'm just not a Carlist.
I wouldn't want to apply Carlism.
Or like a Falangist who...
But I think every country has something that works for it. And it should be done organically. It's not something that can be enforced from the top down. But that's Carlism is a good example for Spain because Carlism respects the organic nature of Spain's history. Right? So that's why I really respect that. And I think you want to apply those things to whatever country you're in, whatever ethnicity you have going on in that country, and the religious traditions in that country as well. Same thing with the system of government. I don't think that monarchy is best for all. I don't think republics are best for all. I think what makes sense for one country won't make sense for another. I think it was Otto von Habsburg who said it would be foolish to consider Spain a republic, as silly as it would be to consider the United States a monarchy. And I agree with that principle.
That's what republic means, but yes.
You understand what I'm saying, though.
Yeah, I've noticed that, like, there's the Catholic rightist groups tend to be more state capitalist or third positionist, economically fascist, while, like, in America, because...
That's the race, man.
No, that's not what I meant. But I mean, while in America, it's more the conservative movement is very economically libertarian.
Unless you're Pat Buchanan.
Yeah, well, Pat Buchanan's no longer really in the mainstream of conservatism.
Well, that's Donald Trump, and that's...
Donald Trump is challenging a lot of those things, and I think some of those challenges can be healthy, although I question Donald Trump's character specifically.
Don't we all?
Yeah, don't we all?
But that really is one of the downfall that has really brought about the, not downfall of Christianity, but the weakening of Christianity in this country, was this kind of unholy alliance between social conservatives and economic liberals and neocon statists. And so you had Christian leaders who should have been anti-war, should have been anti-interventionists, supporting things like the war in Iraq.
And a lot of it you could blame on dispensationalism.
Yep. And it's really hurt the Christian brand, so to speak, in this country. And I think it's going to be a problem that's going to have to be overcome over decades. I don't think it'll be easy.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Another thing is that, like, I've sort of been red-pilled on economics. Like, I'm no longer, like, a hardcore free marketer. Like, I'm not an economic libertarian anymore. Even though, like, in most of, like, the groups I hang out with, especially on Facebook, like, they all tend to be extreme economic libertarians. Like, often in my circles, you hear slogans such as taxation is theft.
Like, you have, you're in the theonomous circles.
Well, a lot of people come to the alt-right through libertarianism.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, the theonomous circles are pretty much becoming libertarian, you know?
Well, they always had that streak, I think, in America.
Yeah, because, you know, it's because of the influence of American conservatism, and I think a lot of it is the founder of the Christian Reconstruction Movement and theonomy, R.J. Rushdoony, he kind of was influenced by witnessing, you know, the subsidies that the Native Americans were getting while he was doing missions with Native Americans. And he noticed that, like, the Native Americans, because of government subsidies, they pretty much have no agency whatsoever.
I think concerning economics and in general, one of the problems this country has is a super rigid ideological approach to things.
Yeah.
You know, and like for when I call myself a distributist, which I do occasionally, my concept of distributism is very, very vague, right? There's no hard and fast rules. Something that might be appropriate in 2016 might be inappropriate in 1980. And I think I think that's just the way it should be. I mean, you know, sometimes you need to have higher taxes, sometimes you need to have lower taxes,
right,
depending on what's going on in the state.
I'm pretty flexible about these things.
It's also
when it's out of king.
Like the conservative movement in this country, because they're so weak, that the only way that they could present a politically correct opposition to the left is by being economically and culturally libertarian, you know?
Well, I think they mouth social conservative talking points.
Yeah. But
in fact, they are culturally libertarian. I mean, anyone who's seen the recent gay marriage situation when it comes to corporations has to understand that big business is just not on our side.
Yeah, I totally agree. I've worked at big businesses, at huge corporations. I mean, one in particular, which is a pretty big corporation that I will not name, you know, but like they pretty much are, I believe they're the most culturally liberal institution that I have ever worked at in my working experience.
Yeah, I think it's coming to a head too, where in order to maintain ourselves as Orthodox Christians, smaller Orthodox, I guess you could say,
yeah,
we'll have to sacrifice things in our lives, and that might mean lucrative jobs.
Yeah, or like you could just pretty much keep yourself from getting doxxed, I guess.
Yeah, well, I mean, we kind of have that situation now. That's why we have a lot of anonymity on Twitter, and I completely understand why. People have families they have to protect, and
yeah,
the current situation, if it's so hostile, especially towards Christianity, I certainly get it. But I think these people who would oppose us, it's not enough for them. They're going to demand it 24/7, every hour of the day, at all times, and it's going to mean that if you want to remain publicly a Christian, you're going to have to be willing to sacrifice some things.
Yeah, that's not my true. People
do not partake in her sins.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's one thing. I mean, being doxxed is obviously a problem if you're doing something that's just kind of neutral. But if you're actually participating in the world in a way that is destructive to the values that you hold, then why are you working at that job?
Yeah. I mean, I was working a short contract at that job. Luckily,
I'm not asking you, I'm not putting you on the line.
I'll speak very specifically for where I work. I work for the Navy, and in my building, the Navy has all kinds of pro liberal propaganda that you are forced to consume on a daily basis. And to be honest with you, I don't really have any experience outside of the Navy. Now, I'm not a serviceman, so I'm not enlisted or anything like that. But there's not really anything that I can jump to without having to make serious changes. So I'm not in a position where I can get up and go quite yet. But to be honest, taking an online quiz that they make us do every year is not as bad as the kind of things I'm talking about.
Well, I'm not talking about that. I mean, that's just whatever. That's just some game you play. But I'm meaning, like, if you're worried about being doxxed at, I'm not meaning anybody here. I'm just saying in general. I mean, if you're worried about, you know, them saying, hey, you're not really one of us, maybe they're right. You know, I mean, maybe they actually have the right to say, hey, man, you're not really one of us.
You know, they kind of notice that, what you're talking about, William, they kind of notice that without you even opening your mouth if you're a true Christian.
Yeah.
Like, I witnessed that at the last job I worked with the city. I won't, of course, name which city, but it was sort of like they, I got a sense that they knew that I was not one of them.
Right.
Yeah, it's, I mean.
Yeah, I think we're definitely at the cusp of a post-Christian world.
Well, it's been post-Christian for a very long time.
Yeah, but not explicitly. It's been that way, yes. But it's not been stated as such. And now we're just getting to the point where we are not only anti-Christian, but we're vocally anti-Christian.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I've seen that my whole life. Really. I mean, I understand what you mean. There's definitely a ramping up, a kind of a desire to finish it off. But the progression has been happening. I mean, I remember it was a few years ago. I woke up and woke up in my mind to just be very disappointed in the evangelical movement, because I thought they were conservative and they were going to hold to their principles, or at least socially conservative and traditionalist in terms of values, and only to find they've, you know, in 30 years they've just cucked themselves. I was never really one, but I thought, okay, well, at least these people will hold on because they believe this stuff.
Right. But that's one of the problems I have with conservative politicians. Isn't necessarily that they fought and lost. It's that they refused to fight in the first place. That's really their great sin.
Mm-hmm. I think it's like, you know,
they got morally outplayed. We were morally outplayed by the left in a way.
They conceded the high ground to the left for no reason.
Yeah,
because the left was anti-racist. The left was tolerant and accepting. And these are all, in some way, these do speak to us as Christian virtues. Now, you know, we've had these conversations before. This is a convolution, but still, I remember spending years kind of feeling incredibly guilty about, you know, wanting to speak against gay marriage, say. And I've written stuff to the diocese. I've written letters to the editor, and I've written letters to priests who were involved in these commissions and these workshops and whatever, about basically training people, you know, the cultural Marxist basically training us to be ready to accept these changes, but feeling really like I'm a big meanie, like I'm nasty, I'm wanting to limit, you know, all of these kinds of things. So those kinds of moral memes are super strong and powerful, and they did definitely you know, bind us. I think we're kind of getting on the other side of that, where actually the degeneracy is manifesting itself. It's not just a theory of acceptance or of tolerance. It's actually hit the ground running, and now we see what that means, because the next thing is pedophilia. The next thing is bestiality, right? This doesn't ever
stop. And we've seen those from places like Ceylon.
Mm-hmm.
Now they've had articles about that.
Polygamy, and from the, you know, and from the Episcopal,
people say polygamy is coming next. No, polygamy is not next.
Yeah. You'd think that polygamy would come before gay marriage, because at least polygamy is historically rooted, and most guys want to be polygamous.
Well, that's because most guys want to be polygamous. Therefore, polygamy is it's an act of patriarchy. That's the reason it's not permitted, thus so, verboten.
There is a difference between traditional polygamy and polyamory. Polyamory is a, you know, that's a thing definitely in SF.
Yeah, isn't polyamory like when
it's just women? Yeah.
Isn't it just like when a woman has multiple husbands?
No, it's loving more.
No, that's polyamory. But polyamory is an arrangement, a sexual arrangement that actually involves more than two people. Whereas traditional polygamy just means that one man has multiple marriages. Not one marriage with multiple women, but multiple parallel marriages with, say, just has three wives. But the wives are not in the same, you know, they're not part of each other's marriages per se, except insofar as, you know, he has just actually apportioned his time and stuff like that.
So basically, in polyamory, the wives are married to each other in addition to being married to a husband, while traditional polygamy, only there's only marriages between the husband and the wife.
Right, so in terms of a sexual image of the marriage as a whole, polyamory is like a threesome rather than a husband being with one wife on one day and the other wife on the next day.
Yeah, polyamory. It sounds disgusting.
Polyamory in the contemporary context. There's a book called the Ethical Slut, which is I've never read it, but I've had friends tell me about it, and it's basically it's just a justification for having no binding relationship with anybody who you're having sex with, and you're just kind of allowed to kind of sleep around and yet have this kind of gloss of philosophical ethical consideration to it. So there's probably some, well, people are supposedly supposed to set up their own rules. So if you're in a marriage or with someone, you don't have to get Tuesdays, or you're not supposed to talk about it, or you are supposed, whatever. I mean, it's all just this, it's just basically chaos described as order.
are you talking about traditional polygamy or polyamory?
No, polyamory as I've encountered it in the West, right, in this city that I live in, when I've heard people talk about it. I mean, it's basically, it just comes, it's classical inertia, marriages don't last, it's hard to want to sleep with the same person for a lifetime. So therefore you're going to want to sleep with other people. So let's discuss it ethically.
Isn't it just like basically having an open relationship?
Yeah, it's an open. Well, you, in the past, open marriages, but none of these people typically are married anymore. They're just people sleeping around, and they call it, I just love everybody I sleep with. I mean, that's all it is. I mean, it's there's no real context, the content to it. It's just, it's anarchist. It's the behavior of anarchists, sexual and mating practice of anarchists. Different than polygamy, which is a formal relationship with responsibilities and support and all the things. It's just you happen to have enough wealth that you can support or whatever number of wives.
Yeah, I'm getting kind of tired here, guys. Should we wrap up soon?
Yeah, I'm ready when you are, Ian.
Deep voice, Ian.
Is Sam? Sam said BRB. I don't want to like just.
Came back. I was just checking if my family came in yet.
Okay, I was just saying I wanted to start wrapping up because I'm getting kind of tired here, and I probably should eat something. I haven't eaten in a while.
It's probably very late where you are. Like, are you on the East Coast?
Yeah, it's almost 11 o'clock here, so.
Yeah.
You can have some kosher tendies there, are you?
Are they kosher? I don't know.
I recommend Cat's Deli.
What now?
I recommend Cat's Deli if you are in New York.
Oh, not in that area, in the mid-Atlantic. But, yeah, I think we should wrap up. All right, I'll just give a little shout-out to everybody who came. So thank you to Mr. Fox. Thank you to Rachel. Thank you to Scott Mallett. And thank you to Joshua Jennings, Henry Gloucester, Mark Citadel, Louis, William Scott, Gregory Carlin, Sam Heidelberg, and Sengen Drake. That's in order of when everybody joined.
All right, and thank you to all you who are listening out there, and it's been a good discussion, guys. Thanks for coming, everyone.
Thank you, Ian.
Have a good night.
Have a good night.
Night, everyone.
Good night.